Wickford Memories by Anita W. Finkley. Wickford Memories by Anita W. Finkley. This fascinating series of reminiscences creates a charming picture of life among the well-to-do but still rural Americans at the end of the last century and the early decades of the present one. Most of the tales center on people and events in the old village of Wickford, Rhode Island, on Narragansett Bay. MRS. Hinckley describes her forebears, childhood and upbringing and her early married life with charm and humor, and she provides many glimpses into the genuine excitement of small town life in that era. Her description, for example, of a Narragansett clam bake is mouth-watering and unforged a table. And all readers will be amused and entertained by such tales as the trials and tribulations of Wickford's fire chief, three murders, the lighthouse keeper's daughter, and Mr. Northrop's remains, as well as many others which prove that almost anything can happen in a small town. One episode has a more cosmopolitan setting and concerns a quite astonishing account of a romance between the author and a Russian prince who was for a time heir apparent to the throne of Russia. He wanted to marry the beautiful American girl, but for reasons of state nobly renounced her. She then married a successful lawyer, and later chapters of Wickford Memories chronicle her happy life with her husband and children. MRS. Hinckley's memories are delightfully illustrated with drawings by Paul Loring. About the author. Anita W. Hinckley was born in Providence, Rhode Island, in 1884. Her childhood and growing up years were spent on a farm in Wickford, a colorful seaport town on Narragansett Bay, Rhode Island. Her remarkable memory has recaptured every detail of those long ago days in this volume. She started writing at the age of 10, but not until her five children were grown up and married did she write seriously. Subsequently, she has had stories published in American Heritage and Yankee, and several of her articles have appeared in the Providence Journal. She was for several years president of the Rhode Island Short Story Club. MRS. Hinckley, the widow of Frank L. Hinckley, a prominent Providence lawyer, has 19 grandchildren and 15 great-grandchildren. Wickford Memories. By Anita W. Hinckley, Boston Brandon Press Publis Bar S. O. Copyright 1972 by Brandon Press, Incorporated. Printed in the United States of America. Library of Congress Catalog Card Number 7283723, Standard Book Number 8283-1360-1. To my children, grandchildren and great-grandchildren, with all my love. Some of the stories and the illustrations by Paul Loring appeared originally in American Heritage, and appear here with the permission of the publisher. Contents. Introductional J.I. My Forebears 19, To Mother and Father 28. Three Cedar Spring Farm 35, Four Childhood Memories 42, V. The Hay Barn 49, Six Teachers 59, 7. Three Murders 62, 8. The Fire Chief 68, 9. Mr. Northrop's Remains 79, X. The Lighthouse Keeper's Daughter 83, XI. Two Other Sisters 87, XII Mike 91, XIII Whale Rock Point ILJ XIV More Pets 109, XV, Why I Am Happy 114. 9. Wickford Memories. Introduction. My memories of Wickford, Rhode Island, are so voluminous and seem to tumble about so and beg to be written with such a rush of delight and fun and tenderness, that I cannot seem to be orderly in my recollections. Memories are queer things, almost human, and have to be written when they want to be. Wickford was a place to dream about, my mother said, when she married my father. She had studied and traveled in Europe for 8 years and was a real cosmopolitan. Then she settled down happily in Wickford for the rest of her 90-year life. When it came my turn to take the grand tour, as all well-educated girls were supposed to do, I enjoyed several marvelous years in Europe. But I was always glad to get back to Wickford, where things were happening. Wickford is on the west shore of Narragansett Bay, right on the salt water. There are many saltwater coves and inlets. I think that is what gives Wickford such a fresh, invigorating air. One cannot be more than a mile from the saltwater anywhere. The shore in most places is a high bank, with a strip of sandy beach below. The tide averages 5 to 6 feet, and, on the two main beaches it goes out nearly a mile at low tide, leaving a fine place for clamming, crabbing, and other shell fishing. You could always tell the natives, because they went swimming at low tide, in order to combine it with supplementing their larder. While the visitors, the women in black bathing suits and long black stockings, and the men in black union suits swam at high tide. Wickford never was a big place. It always had self-respecting, hard-working people, mostly of English stock. Fishing was the largest industry, with farming second. Almost everyone had a couple of horses, a cow, a few sheep, and some poultry. Of course, farming was a sideline, and until my childhood was looked down on, and the less intelligent boys in the big families had to do the farm work. But the eaves were just lath and plaster of the bedroom ceilings. This once caused a near catastrophe, as I shall tell later. There are still many of these beautiful old houses on Main Street, and they are a great source of pride to the town folk. In one of the oldest houses is a fine bookstore, and diagonally, they ran away fishing when they could, and occasionally across the street, our newspaper, the Wickford Standard. Boy went to New Bedford and became a whaler. It is said that although many boats were built in Wickford, only 2-3-masted schooners were built there. One was the Mary Gardiner, named after my great-great-grandmother, the other was the Temperance. The Mary Gardiner had a hand-carved figurehead of my great-great-grandmother, which looks like me but has a black bodice, a full red pleated skirt and black slippers. The stern of the ship had an enormous white seagull with widespread wings. Both of these relics I still have. I think my lovely old Canton china may have been brought back on one of these ships, which went all over the world, but I don't believe great-great-grandpa knew old china from horseradish. In the early days, everyone built their houses on the salt water. They had sturdy boats always ready, so they could escape from the Indians in case of attack. Those Narragansett Indians were very fierce. Many of the old houses still have their little coves and beaches, where children play now and one can bathe and swim. The houses were nearly all of white clapboards, with a big central chimney and a fireplace in every room. Their front door opened on a small entry with a steep, winding staircase going to the second floor. The third floor was an attic, with bunks for the boys. It was heated, after a fashion, with some heat from the big chimney, which was always warm. Only the central part was floored with planks, while the sections under. Now am its 79th year. My grandfather, Captain David Sherman Baker, lived in a very old gambrel-roofed house where the Bakers first lived, on Pleasant Street. Later he moved to a larger house on Fowler Street, for with 6 sons, Nick, Charlie, Ben, David, my father, Tom, Billy, and 1 daughter, Abby, my grandparents needed extra room. Another thing that everyone is very proud of is the Charles C. Baker Post, which was started at the beginning of the Civil War. Charles Baker was one of my father's older brothers, and he was the first casualty of the Civil War from Rhode Island. Every Decoration Day we go to the cemetery and put flowers on his grave. My grandmother never went. She and her only daughter, Abby, sat at home and looked at Charlie's few possessions and grieved as only women can who had lost their best. Historically, the most interesting building in town is the old Narragansett Episcopal Church, built in 1707, and moved from McSparren Hill to Wickford after Dr. McSparren, the first rector, died. It has big square pews and small paned RCHEDWMDO/SWIT nice paneling, and a lovely high pulpit with small stairs GOMG up to it. The beautiful set of communion silver which Queen Anne sent from England to old St. Paul's is still in use. Dr. McSparren lived in a small house called the Glebe on the west side of the Pettaquamset River. About 3 miles farther down the road and across a bridge, in the early days of Ford, is the artist Gilbert Stuart's birthplace. It is like 15. The houses I have described, except that it has a basement beside a stone dam in the river, and in it a big mill wheel to grind corn. It is a fascinating place, beautifully restored and furnished, and the mill is still in perfect working order. Pond lilies and other wildflowers grow along the banks of the river. Gilbert Stuart, with his love of beauty, must have annoyed his home, and after he left, I am sure, thought longingly of it, especially in the fall, when the foliage is the most gorgeous I know anywhere. In one of the deep coves that come from Wickford by Cornelius Island, is a big square house with an enormous chimney, that is called Kickham's Cassette, or Smith's Castle. It was there that Roger Williams, a canny, far-seeing man, and Richard Smith started their first trading post. The first building was a log house and stockade where the soldiers lived before and during the Great Swamp Fight of 1675. It was burned by the Indians in 1676, but the few men who survived the Great Fight came back to rebuild the house. By 1680 Richard Smith had completed the rebuilding, and the place was called Smith's Castle. It is a beautiful gambrel roofed house, with large rooms, each with a fireplace, and a lovely view down the long saltwater cove, a mile or more to Wickford. An old-fashioned garden, with snapdragons, marigolds, tulips, daisies, and bee balm, looks much as it must have when Roger Till Eames and Richard Smith started out from here for the great swamp fight, and when they brought back to it their 40 dead. This lovely old village, which has meant so much to generations of my family and is so close to my heart, has prompted me to write these reminiscences. Wickford Memories. Anita Hinckley. Chapter I. My Forebears. Many of the men in Wickford were sea captains, and almost all of my forebears were. They loved the sea and farmed as a sideline. And the boys, as they grew up, built boats, made docks, and worked in the shipyards. For years my grandfather Baker sailed the packet carrying the mill from Wickford over to Newport, on the other side of the bay, and all his boys, as they grew old enough, helped him. The boys were all very tall and fine-looking. Nick, the oldest, grew fast and was always tired, as most overgrown boys are. One winter day he decided he had worked long enough and needed a rest. He told his father his foot hurt him, so he couldn't make the trip. "Let's see, Nicky. My, that is serious. I you must not put your shoe on. But no one will notice. Come along just the same." Captain Baker picked up poor Nicky's shoe, and for 2 days Nick traveled one shoe off and one shoe on, in the bitter weather. His brothers never let him forget it, and many times in life asked him, "Where's your shoe, Nicky?" Miss Willie Cotter, a cousin, who was very fond of Captain Baker, worried about his winter trips, and finally called on him and said, "Captain David, I feel it is my duty to warn you to give up taking the mail to Newport. Something will happen to you. Your grandfather was lost at sea, your father was lost at sea, and your brother was lost at sea." "All right, Miss Willie, but don't you ever go to bed again. Your mother died in bed, your father died in bed, and your grandfather died in bed." Captain Baker kept on sailing, and he, bless his heart, also died in bed. My father, David Sherman Baker, J.R., was a captain with his papers from the custom house when he was 13 years old. He was 6'3" then and never grew after that. My father and his brother, Ben, after they had finished school in Wickford, went to the East Greenwich Academy, 7 miles away. They walked there in the fall when the term began, and soon grew very homesick. Many days they would walk back till they could look down on Wickford and their home from the hill back of the town, be comforted that it was still there, and walk the 7 miles back to East Greenwich. They felt it was not fitting to visit their family until the term ended. I don't believe that father ever told his mother about that. Three of the 6 sons, including father, worked their way through school and college to become lawyers. My grandmother Baker was well disposed toward everyone, A to D very witty. She came of a race of giants. She was nearly 6 feet tall, and her 7 brothers were all over 6'6", and the tallest 7'4". It is from her, I suppose, that my father and later my brother and I got her height. She could always tell a funny story, and possessed the rare gift of being able to laugh at herself. Poor darling, she needed all her humor the last years of her life, for she became afflicted, / with an odd disease. She would go in just the opposite direction from where she wanted to go, and the harder she tried not to, the worse it got. If she wanted to go into the garden, she would go into the kitchen. Once, I remember, I was all dressed up to go to church and went to call on her first. She wanted to come into the parlor and see me and she got under the bed and couldn't get out. I got under, too, and tried to push her out, but she was as big as I was, and heavier. In some way, she got me wedged in, and Grandpa and Father had to lift the bed up to get us out. I was ruined for church. Grandpa got religion quite late in life. It came on him all of a sudden, and in winter. He wanted and insisted that he be baptized at once, in the Baptist church. The Baptists immersed for baptism, and the minister wanted Grandpa to wait until warmer weather. He said Grandpa had waited 55 years, and a few more months couldn't hurt him. But Grandpa had great zeal, so they all went to the river. It is said that the crowd was large and cut the ice, and the minister and Grandpa went in. Grandpa was much bigger than Parson Dawes, and when the parson immersed Grandpa he sort of let go, and Grandpa's head went under the ice, and one of the deacons had to help pull Grandpa out and help them both to shore. They were so numbed with cold. Grandpa said it did him a lot of good and he tried to make his sons be immersed. Some of them were, but they waited till summer. Mother was born in Brookline, Massachusetts, into a large family of grandparents, aunts, uncles, and cousins. Her mother died at her birth, and her father was left a widower at 22 years of age. After his wife died, his oldest sister, Sue, a spinster of uncertain temper who was usually cross, kept house for him. Grandfather was very strict and unbending, and when things went wrong, which they always seemed to do, Mother had no one to understand or take her part. She did not intend to be naughty, but everyone was always telling her she was. The new leather reins were left out all night, Mother was blamed, although all the children in the neighborhood had been playing horse with them, and she would be sent supperless to bed. Once she was given a miniature iron table to play with. She was told, "You break everything. Here is one thing you can't break." Although she was only 3 years old, she remembered feeling that her honor was at stake and that she must break the table. So she wiggled it and kept hitting it until it broke, and she was punished. When she was about 8 years old, she was so unhappy that she did not want to live. She had been scolded and punished so often. One day at the family dinner table, they had an especially nice meal and she was very hungry. Inadvertently, she hit the maid's arm and spilled something. Her father screamed at her and sent her away dinnerless. She stumbled blindly upstairs. On the landing, she suddenly discerned through her tears the loveliest lady she had ever seen. The lady held out her arms, and Mother rushed into them, knowing instinctively that the apparition was her own mother. "You are not a bad girl, my darling," said the vision, holding Mother close and kissing her hair. "You are a good girl and I love you." The lady had a sweet voice and looked like her own portrait in the parlor, and she was wearing the same dress. The vision changed Mother's entire life. Afterward, whenever anyone accused her of being naughty or bad, she would say, "I'm not. My mother thinks I'm good." The confidence and faith which inspired her answer were disconcerting to those who knew how long my grandmother had been dead. Mother always welcomed the summer, for then she and her sisters, Cora and Lucy, were sent to visit relatives. One was their father's mother, Grandma Candler, who lived in a lovely old marble headhouse. The staircase is now in a museum, near but not on the water. As a girl, Grandma Candler had said that there were three things she would never do: marry a sea captain, marry a man named John, or marry a widower. Grandfather Candler was all three. His first wife died when he was only 20, while he was on a trip to China. He married Grandma when he was 24 and she was 18. They had seven children. One of these, Uncle Fred, went to China and married a Chinese girl. We have been told that the first part of her Gesheimer's Java head was based on Fred's experiences in the Orient. After being absent many years, he made a visit home, bringing us rich and exquisite gifts, and was about to return to China when he caught a severe cold and died. About 2 years after his death, we received word that two of his sons were coming to America on a visit. Such consternation that what would we do with Chinese boys who were also first cousins? They eventually arrived and were met at the steamer by some of the men of the family. Instead of boys, they were tall, dignified, solemn Chinese gentlemen who had come as a filial duty to visit their father's grave. They wanted nothing of us and would not even pay us a social call. They visited their father's grave in the lovely old Moravian cemetery on Staten Island, and then went back to China. But the relative my mother loved best to visit was her mother's father, Grandpa Cobb, at his home in Amherst, Massachusetts. It was a beautiful farm and he was a splendid farmer. Grandpa Cobb was an austere man. The only person he really loved was Mother, for she looked like his beloved wife, Augusta Adams, who had run away from him years before. Gay, beautiful, and lively, Augusta had married Grandpa Cobb when she was 16 and he was much older. Within 5 years she had six babies, and she felt that her life was strenuous and dull. In those days, in Amherst, one of the principal forms of entertainment was evening lectures. Everyone went. One of the lectures on a dreary winter night was Brigham Young, and the whole town turned out to hear him. He was a mag. Captain Baker kept on sailing, and he, bless his heart, also died in bed. My father, David Sherman Baker, J.R., was a captain with his papers from the custom house when he was 13 years old. He was 6'3" then and never grew after that. My father and his brother, Ben, after they had finished school at Wickford, went to the East Greenwich Academy, 7 miles away. They walked there in the fall when the term began, and soon grew very homesick. Many days they would walk back till they could look down on Wickford and their home from the hill back of the town, be comforted that it was still there, and walk the 7 miles back to East Greenwich. They felt it was not fitting to visit their family until the term ended. I don't believe that father ever told his mother about that. Three of the six sons, including father, worked their way through school and college to become lawyers. My grandmother Baker was well disposed toward everyone, and very witty. She came of a race of giants. She was nearly 6 feet tall, and her seven brothers were all over 6 foot six, and the tallest 7 foot four. It is from her, I suppose, that my father and later my brother and I got her height. She could always tell a funny story, and possessed the rare gift of being able to laugh at herself. Poor darling, she needed all her humor the last years of her life, for she became afflicted with an odd disease. She would go in just the opposite direction from where she wanted to go, and the harder she tried not to, the worse it got. If she wanted to go into the garden, she would go into the kitchen. Once, I remember, I was all dressed up to go to church and went to call on her first. She wanted to come into the parlor and see me, and she got under the bed and couldn't get out. I got under, too, and tried to push her out, but she was as big as I was, and heavier. In some way, she got me wedged in, and Grandpa and Father had to lift the bed up to get us out. I was ruined for church. Grandpa got religion quite late in life. It came on him all of a sudden, and in winter. He wanted and insisted that he be baptized at once, in the Baptist church. The Baptists immersed for baptism, and the minister wanted Grandpa to wait until warmer weather. He said Grandpa had waited 55 years, and a few more months couldn't hurt him. But Grandpa had great zeal, so they all went to the river. It is said that the crowd was large and cut the ice, and the minister and Grandpa went in. Grandpa was much bigger than Parson Dawes, and when the parson immersed Grandpa he sort of let go, and Grandpa's head went under the ice, and one of the deacons had to help pull Grandpa out and help them both to shore. They were so numbed with cold. Grandpa said it did him a lot of good, and he tried to make his sons be immersed. Some of them were, but they waited till summer. Mother was born in Brookline, Massachusetts, into a large family of grandparents, aunts, uncles, and cousins. Her mother died at her birth, and her father was left a widower at 22 years of age. After his wife died, his oldest sister, Sue, a spinster of uncertain temper who was usually cross, kept house for him. Grandfather was very strict and unbending, and when things went wrong, which they always seemed to do, Mother had no one to understand or take her part. She did not intend to be naughty, but everyone was always telling her she was. The new leather reins were left out all night, Mother was blamed, although all the children in the neighborhood had been playing horse with them, and she would be sent supperless to bed. Once she was given a miniature iron table to play with. She was told, "You break everything. Here is one thing. 21. You can't break." Although she was only 3 years old, she remembered feeling that her honor was at stake and that she must break the table. So she wiggled it and kept hitting it until it broke, and she was punished. When she was about 8 years old, she was so unhappy that she did not want to live. She had been scolded and punished so often. One day at the family dinner table they had an especially nice meal and she was very hungry. Inadvertent lie, she hit the maid's arm and spilled something. Her father screamed at her and sent her away dinnerless. She stumbled blindly upstairs. On the landing she suddenly discerned through her tears the loveliest lady she had ever seen. The lady held out her arms, and Mother rushed into them, knowing instinctively that the apparition was her own mother. "You are not a bad girl, my darling," said the vision, holding Mother close and kissing her hair. "You are a good girl and I love you." The lady had a sweet voice and looked like her own portrait in the parlor, and she was wearing the same dress. The vision changed Mother's entire life. Afterward, whenever anyone accused her of being naughty or bad, she would say, "I'm not. My mother thinks I'm good." The confidence and faith which inspired her answer were disconcerting to those who knew how long my grandmother had been dead. Mother always welcomed the summer, for then she and her sisters, Cora and Lucy, were sent to visit relatives. One was their father's mother, Grandma Candler, who lived in a lovely old marble head house. The staircase is now in a museum, near but not on the water. As a girl, Grandma Candler had said that there were three things she would never do: marry a sea captain, marry a man named John, or marry a widower. Grandfather Candler was all three. His first wife died when 12. He was only 20, while he was on a trip to China. He married Grandma when he was 24 and she was 18. They had seven children. One of these, Uncle Fred, went to China and married a Chinese girl. We have been told that the first part of her Gesheimer's Java head was based on Fred's experiences in the Orient. After being absent many years, he made a visit home, bringing us rich and exquisite gifts, and was about to return to China when he caught a severe cold and died. About 2 years after his death, we received word that two of his sons were coming to America on a visit. Such consternation that what would we do with Chinese boys who were also first cousins? They eventually arrived and were met at the steamer by some of the men of the family. Instead of boys, they were tall, dignified, solemn Chinese gentlemen who had come as a filial duty to visit their father's grave. They wanted nothing of us and would not even pay us a social call. They visited their father's grave in the lovely old Moravian cemetery on Staten Island, and then went back to China. But the relative my mother loved best to visit was her mother's father, Grandpa Cobb, at his home in Amherst, Massachusetts. It was a beautiful farm and he was a splendid farmer. Grandpa Cobb was an austere man. The only person he really loved was Mother, for she looked like his beloved wife, Augusta Adams, who had run away from him years before. Gay, beautiful, and lively, Augusta had married Grandpa Cobb when she was 16 and he was much older. Within 5 years she had 6 babies, and she felt that her life was strenuous and dull. In those days, in Amherst, one of the principal forms of entertainment was evening lectures. Everyone went. One of the lectures on a dreary winter night was Brigham Young, and the whole town turned out to hear him. He was a mag. 23. Netic, fascinating speaker, and a handsome man, and he held the women as PLBUND. He told them of the complete freedom that women enjoyed under the Mormon religion. No woman was compelled to have children unless she wanted them. Every woman had a house of her own and invited her husband when she wanted to see him. To Augusta this sounded like heaven. After the lecture, when everyone went up to shake hands with him, he held Augusta's hand long enough to find out her name and whether she was married. One afternoon about 6 weeks later, a young man appeared at the kitchen door and asked for Mrs. Cobb. "I am Mrs. Cobb," said Augusta. "I have a message for you from the prophet. He feels drawn toward you and wants you to come to him in Utah." "But I have no money," Augusta said falteringly. "You need not then, G," the young man assured her. "Everything will be provided. You may bring any of your children you wish. You do not have to decide at once. I am on my way back to Boston and in 10 days I will be back. If you want to come, be ready. I will come at this time of day and will have every convenience arranged for your comfort." Augusta was ready and went with him. She took with her the youngest child, Charlotte, a babe in arms. Grandpa's rage was thunderous. He started right off, went out to Utah, and brought her home. They had 2 more children, James and, 1 Ursie. And then Estee left for good, returning to Utah MTAC, 109, the last 2 with her, but leaving Charlotte and the rest behind. A few years ago, Mother and I, visiting 2 of my daughters at Smith College in Northampton, went over to Amherst to see the farm again. When we went into the big barn, Mother said, "The last time I was here, Grandpa put the curry comb and brush back of a board behind this door." She, 24, put her hand down and brought it out. Grandpa had put it there 72 years before. When Mother was 14, Grandfather Candler bought a yacht, hired a house in Newport, and took his 3 daughters there. He did not take Aunt Sue along, and she was furious. But Grandfather was smart. He knew that a widower with a yacht and 3 pretty daughters might be more interesting and acceptable than a widower with an acidulous old maid sister. They had a lovely time. Cora, the oldest, was a beautiful companion to her handsome and amusing father. They were invited everywhere and did a great deal of entertaining at home and aboard the yacht. Lucy and Mother were considered too young to go out in the evening, but they had each other and spent many happy days at Bailey's Beach. Grandfather later married a girl less than 6 months older than Cora. Then Cora married an artist and went to Paris to jive. Mother joined them soon afterward and jived in France for 8 years. They enjoyed a gay bohemian life in the Latin Quarter. Uncle Charlie, Cora's husband, amused us for years with his tales of Mother's escapades in Paris. After 8 years in Paris, they all came home for the summer. Cora had 2 children, a boy and a girl. Grandfather had another daughter, looked much older, and had been spending his summers aboard the yacht. Now that the family was augmented, he hired a house in Wickford, at Duck Cove Farm. It was a sweet, friendly place with beautiful elm trees lining the drive to the house, which stood right on the water. Grandfather wanted a good harbor for his sloop, the Grey Goose. Grandfather must have mellowed through the years, for when he came to live with us, at the age of 72, he was the gayest, most charming person imaginable. He had, 25, been everywhere, but he loved Wickford. You don't realize what you have, he would say. Here is everything to delight the soul. And then, dear man, romance struck him. My mother and father were aghast, but so gentle. He told us about it at dinner one night. I have tried for days to get you two together, but it seemed useless. I am in love with Miss Louise Hoppin and want to marry her, and she says she would like to marry me. I know it seems fantastic, but wait till you're my age and lonely, and a lovely person comes into your life. Why shouldn't we have a few years of happiness? Mother spoke first, darling, it is too perfect. I love Miss Lou, and am so pleased and honored she cares for you. When do you want to get married? As soon as possible, he replied, and asked Father, can I have the red cottage in Wickford next to you? Of course you can, said Father. M.R. Candler, I have lived long enough, and so has Nita, to know that love has no age. Miss Lou wanted Grandfather to have a photograph taken for her. He did, and in his new light spring suit that he had bought to be married in, went to Roger/Williams Park to the park photographer. He caught pneumonia. In less than a week he was gone, holding her hand. Chapter 2, Mother and Father. After Grandfather Candler went to Duck Cove Farm, he and his family were warmly received in Wickford society. Among those who welcomed them into their circle of friends was Dr. David Greer, rector of St. Paul's Episcopal Church, and his gracious family. One of their friends was David Sherman Baker, a native of Wickford and an unmarried young lawyer. Dr. Greer suggested one day that he introduce young Baker to Miss Candler, who had only recently come to town. Do excuse me, said the young man, but I am working very hard just now, and I already know so many girls. Dr. Greer laughed. The serious young man asked, what are you laughing at? That is exactly what Miss Candler said when I asked her to meet you, said Dr. Greer. They were married the following June and went to live at Cedar Spring Farm. It was their home as long as they lived, father and mother for 26 years together, and mother 42 years longer alone. VHE and mother was a bride, her next door neighbors were a fisherman and his ex-schoolteacher wife. L/NTHER was lonely, and she and Mrs. Jenkins became great friends. Mrs. Jenkins used to help mother in many ways, taught her to cook, and was fascinated with mother's stories of Europe and her French clothes. One day, after Mrs. Jenkins had broken bread with mother many times, she asked mother to dinner. Mother wondered if Mr. Jenkins would be there also. He was a very informal person and always went about barefooted, she had noticed. 28. The dinner was at noon. Mother went I. LACMPL little house dress and there was Mr. Jenkins SUNNG stiffly through the parlor in formal dress clothes, white tie and tails, and patent leather shoes. Mother must have shown her surprise, for MRS. Jenkins waved her hand toward her husband and said grandly, Mr. Jenkins always dresses for dinner. Mother lost her first baby and was very ill afterward. Dr. Noyes, a wise man, told my father she should wait at least 2 years before having another. She was so lonely and heartbroken that Dr. Noyes asked my grandmother to try to interest her in a flower garden, which she did. Being outdoors and working in the garden would be the cure. Many kind women in /Vickford brought mother old-fashioned plants and small shrubs and perennials and showed her how to plant things. It was a new life and a fascinating one. Mother did not mention to father what she was doing, and he, busy end to end, was only glad to see her looking better, and as had no questions. On the northwest corner of our land, hidden from the cottage next door by lilacs and syringas and smoke bushes, there was a grassy bank that sloped down to a little level place, about 100 feet square. It was a charming, secluded place, out of sight of both us, but near enough for anyone to be heard calling from the dining room window. A friend taught mother to make wide grass paths and very narrow flower beds. In the center of the garden, mother put a round flower bed and a little statue of a fawn that she had bought in France. I think it was during the second summer of mother's garden that a friend coming to call said, what's this I hear about your garden, Nita? Father looked up. Where is it? Right down that little bank. Let's see it. Father was absolutely speechless. It was so lovely, and that July Sunday morning after a rain spell just showed it off. Father could talk of nothing else. He was so proud and took everyone to see it. Mother did not want all this fuss. It was her little solace and she wanted it that way. But father, big bumble puppy of a man, got an architect to come and see what else they could do to improve Cedar Spring Farm. The architect was enchanted too, but said that mother's garden ought to be on the level and show from the dining room window. He made plans enough to last for years, and to be very costly. After he left, father asked mother what she thought about them. "I am sure they are all right," she said, "but let's not do anything now. Wait a year and see what we want." The architect was not to be put off so easily. He badgered father and drew more plans, which mother would not look at. But the main thing he insisted on was that mother's garden be raised and the land be made level. Just then father had to go to Washington to try a case before the Supreme Court. He took mother with him, and they were gone 10 days. Mother could hardly wait to get home. Her yucca lilies should be in bloom. It was the middle of July, and everyone had told her the autumn before that they were very difficult to transplant and that they would flower only if they had the yucca moth to pollinate them. Mother chattered happily and said how well she felt and talked of her garden. Poor father said later that a hand clutched his heart. He had not told the architect to fill in that garden, but he had not told him not to. If he thought he was pleasing mother, he would hurry to fill in the garden and have the work done when she got home. They got home after dark. "Go." The next morning father woke up to find mother's half of the bed empty. He rushed out, and there was mother sobbing convulsively and lying on the level brown earth, with her flowers, shrubs, and plants in a canvas-covered heap under the big maple. Mother was an understanding woman. She knew how everything had happened, and she did not blame father. But she never had another garden. She always had lots of flowers in odd places, but never again a formal garden, and she never spoke of it. I was born the following year, and I hope I was able to take up mother's time and make her so busy that she was not able to think of her garden. Father and mother later had two more daughters, Gladys and Ruth, and a son, David, Jr. We lived at Cedar Spring most of our lives, and afterward it became an enchanting second home for our children. Family pictures were a tradition with us, and we got many a good laugh over some of them. One especially was the Crockers' Christmas picture. Once when we were little, about a month before Christmas, mother received a forlorn letter from Aunt Betty telling, among other troubles, how Uncle C. Auger had no job and the children apparently none of any THMG. Mother and father talked late that night and decided they would give up Christmas that year, except for some cheap toys for us children, and send all the money to the Crockers, and, David, mother said, let's do it right away, so the poor things can have a Christmas and get things now when they need them. My parents sent the money right away. The day before Christmas a big flat package came to the house, and we opened it. Inside was a huge, elaborate photograph of all the smiling Crockers, not one copy, but one for each of us. They had spent all the Christmas money on their panoramic family photograph. 51. My father kept his copy of the picture hanging beside his bureau to the day he died. The card addressed to him was inserted in the corner, and under his name he had written Sucker. He said it was one of the best lessons he ever had. They were a homely family. But another photograph, which always made mother weep, gently, was the one taken the day before father's funeral. / Viet Hien in Europe that summer and had had the most wonderful time and had all bought beautiful dresses to wear at Glady's coming out party. My father kept begging us to have our picture taken to our worth dresses. But after the coming out ball there were lots of parties, and football games, more parties, my brother died home for vacation, more parties, Christmas, more parties, David leaving for school. We couldn't stop long enough to have our picture taken. Then like a ton of bricks father's pneumonia. It could not be fatal, of course. He would be all right. He was only 50, and so big and strong and red-cheeked and gay, but he wasn't all right. He gasped for breath. We sent for more doctors. First we couldn't speak, then we hanged the doctors to do something. Father turned gray and choked. "Whldle?" In the corner of his room, mother on her knees beside his, head holding his hand all night. Toward morning he spoke, hoarsely and haltingly. "Nita, darling, I can't make it. It is a stone wall and I can't get over it." "Oh, my darling?" Mother put her hand on his hand, we didn't look. But after a while a terrible nurse crackled in his throat, and one gasping groan the nurses came and put us out and said it was over and that father was dead. The doctor gave us all something to make us sleep. When we woke, father was gone to the undertaker's. They told us and mother was white as a sheet and my aunt had come from Boston. There was much to be done, and we were very busy. We all had black clothes and big black veils on our black hats. Every time mother looked at us, she cried, / fever sighthtsl she cried all the time, as we did. The day before the funeral, there was a lull. We just sat and looked at one another, all funny with swollen eyes, and David in his first wing collar and a black suit and tie. Mother began to cry more than ever, and sobbed, "If we had only had our pictures taken as your father wanted us tall, now we look so terrible, and my life is over. Let's do it right now." "What are you talking of?" "I mean what I say. / we can never wear our beautiful clothes again, and we promised Papa." "Someone, I think David telephoned the photographer, who came within the hour." We got dressed up, sobbing and putting cold water on our eyes so they wouldn't look so swollen, and had the picture taken just as he had wanted us to. And it was a comfort and made him seem nearer, and we all promised that we would always live as he would have wished. It was a secret and a bond, and in the awful days that followed, when we had to give up the house in town and sell almost everything, and Mother was so lonely and frightened, that picture which came out perfectly and everyone looked really better than he or she could was a symbol that we were united and could rise to emergencies. Everyone who saw the picture said, "How lucky you had it taken and didn't wait. Didn't your father love it? It flatters you all, you look really starry-eyed." It seems a long time ago that Father taught me to read the Bible and live by it, as his father did. It has been a help. SS. All through the years. He also suggested that each year the psalm corresponding to one's age be committed to memory, and that it would be a comfort. And so it has been. Mother and I read the 90th psalm a few weeks before she died at 90 years of age. "How true it all is," she said, and repeated, "Let the beauty of the Lord be upon us." She had a life of wonderful health and great beauty. I had her a long time, and during the last years she was my baby and my comfort. She was so wise and humorous and had lived through so many wars all, she said, about nothing, they only killed the best and left broken hearts and homes. Mother failed rapidly after VJ Day. Nothing definite, just a general lassitude. I knew I should feel reconciled. 90 is a great age, and Mother really wanted to go. "You know, dear, I feel as if I would see your father soon, just think it is 42 years. The night I dreamt of my mother the first night after her death, she looked so young and well. Are you happy, darling?" I asked. "Yes," she said, rather doubtfully. "Do you like it where you are?" "Not much," Mother confessed. "It's too quiet." Just then George Cranston, the Wickford undertaker who died 40 years before Mother, came tearing up the street. He yelled at Mother, "Hill, you can't do this." Then I woke up. S4. Chapter 3. Cedar Spring Farm. My father inherited Cedar Spring Farm from some uncles. Inherited isn't exactly the word. He assumed the mortgage. No money changed hands, for no one had any. He brought my mother there as a bride, and she loved it, as did her children and grandchildren. The farm was named for the little spring, called by the Indians after the cedar grove which surrounds it. The spring never fails, and the water is pure and cold, rushing out of the ground at about 50 gallons a minute and flowing into the saltwater cove nearby. When Father and Mother arrived at Cedar Spring on the first evening of their honeymoon, they found there was no stove there. So for their first meal, Father made Rhode Island Johnny Cakes in the fireplace. After that, Johnny Cakes became a family ritual. My father insisted on having them both for dinner every night and for breakfast every morning. In fact, every meal he ate at home, Father had Johnny Cakes. For perfect Johnny Cakes, a very special method of preparation is required. First of all, the white cornmeal must be ground very slowly, so that the millstones do not get hot and burn the meal. 2/3 of last year's and 1/3 of this year's is used, because to use all this year's meal makes it too moist. The meal, with some salt, is put in a pottery bowl and heated red hot, either in the oven or over a fire. It must be so hot that a slight crust forms on top. While the meal is heating, a soapstone or iron griddle should also be heated, and a kettle of water set on to boil. S5. Any fat bacon, lard, butter, etc. can be used on the griddle. After the meal is red hot and the water is actively boiling, the water should be poured onto the meal a little at a time and stirred in. The meal should be kept on the stove or as near the fire as possible, for it must not be allowed to chill. When the water and meal are well mixed, the more stirring or beating the better, the meal should be soft enough to drop off a spoon. When the griddle is red hot, and covered with a very thin film of grease, the top of the mixture should be scraped with a large spoon and dropped onto the griddle. The meal should always be scraped off the top, and when the first batch of cakes is on the griddle, it should be beaten up again, and the top scraped for the next batch, and so on. The cake should never be patted or touched until it is turned over to be cooked on the other side. All this trouble is worthwhile, for the Johnny cakes will be light as air and the crust will melt in one's mouth. Cedar Spring Farm was always a land of plenty. At one time or another we raised about everything a farm affords. Such quantities of everything. In the fall, getting ready for winter and collecting all the food to be stored took much planning and lots of arguing and arranging. Our cellar at Cedar Spring was large, and under the high windows along the south side of the cellar were the barrels of molasses, hard cider, sweet cider, salt pork, and oysters in their shells. The oysters were the last things put in the cellar, and winter was really at hand when my father and the two Freeman boys, Ben and Pete, carried the big barrel of oysters and seaweed down cellar. Every Sunday the oysters were fed a handful of bran and they made a suckling noise eating quite plain to be heard. Whether the ones on the bottom of the barrel got any bran. 36. I don't know, but the ones on top were the first eaten, so their turn came soon enough. Pete would ask Ben if he had given the oysters their sauce. He was so kind-hearted that he didn't want even oysters to go hungry. It was Ben's job to attend to the barrels and open oysters and pick out the salt pork. Once during a party, my father took some men down cellar to get more oysters and show them how the oysters were fed, and they fed the bran to the salt pork barrel. Mother didn't stop teasing father about that for weeks. It didn't seem to hurt the salt pork any. / Vietnams and bacon hanging in the wine room, and a barrel of Medford rum was locked in there too. Sausage making came in the fall when the little pigs were ready to be eaten. The sausage meat was simple to make. One person fed meat into tea la grande with herbs and spices and another turned the grmder handle. The meat came out a lovely shade of pink and was pulled down in a thick wooden hull in a cold place till the sausage casings were PRCPALD. I is as th hard and unpleasant part. The casings, made hom the etasms of the pig, had to be turned inside out and washed carefully, then the casing turned back. We had Mr. Grandison, the rubbish man, wash and fix the casings for us. All broken pieces and trash he got for nothing. The CASMG was his aunt. The funnel of the filling machine and TH meat filled into it from the top. Every 4 inches the CASMG had to be turned twice, and that made the individual sausage. Many times the fragile casing would break and the meat squirt all over everything. It requires care and delicate fingers to fill sausages. The long garlands of sausages were then draped over clotheslines in the buttery and left over night. The weather had to be cold to make good sausages. We had a friend who came to call and said he knew how to help. 37. Us. My. He was clumsy. He got the casings all mixed. Broke them. And got the meat all over himself and us. We had to stop for that day. Housekeeping was easier then. For the same day every week we would have the same thing. Every Saturday night's dinner consisted of oysters, or little necks and the months with no R, on the half shell. Then a clear soup. Then broiled live lobsters. A green vegetable, and of course Johnny cake, and Indian pudding with thick cream for dessert. Sunday dinner was always a thick soup, roast beef with grated horseradish in cream, a green vegetable, Yorkshire pudding, and floating island with jelly on the islands. Thursday lunch was roast chicken, and at night cook's not up cold chicken, always so good. Almost every Sunday evening in the summer, at Whale Rock, we used to have a clam bake. Ed Standevin, a past master at clam bakes, prepared them. There are master clam bake creators, just as there are master chefs and master brewers. He gathered a seaweed at morning low tide and started his fire to heat the stones. Then he wrapped all the contents of the bacon cheesecloth squares, the dams, lobsters, chickens, potatoes, and sweet corn. After the stones were red hot, the wood was raked off and a blanket of fresh green seaweed laid on the stones. Quick lie, on top of this, were put the wrapped young split broilers. Then, after another layer of seaweed, the potatoes and sweet corn, then more seaweed and the lobsters. More seaweed still, then the clams about 2 quarts to a cheesecloth square. The last layer of seaweed was spread over the clams, and over the whole mound was fastened a big piece of canvas or an old sail. Baking time was about 2 hours. The bake was eaten in the order it was: uncovered clams first, and chickens last. We always provided a whole lobster. 38. I. For each person, and a quart of clams, and usually didn't have enough. Once, a few years ago, a Russian brought by a friend ate 20 lobsters. He simply grabbed the lobster, twisted the tail and pulled out the meat, and ate it grandly, throwing away the claws and the body. There were incidentals at the bake's clam broth, for instance, and brown bread and butter, something to drink, and dessert. The broth was made by steaming a bushel of clams in a big kettle with a cup full of water over the fire made of the raked-off wood. This took about 20 minutes and was ready by the time the cocktails were finished. / V usually had soft drinks and beer with the bake, unless it was a wedding bake or a very fancy one, when we had champagne. / V considered watermelon or some other fruit the best dessert, but sometimes we sank so low as to have ice cream cones. / V were very particular about our cider, too. No wormy apples were allowed. Every apple was carefully picked, and the straw used in the press was clean and changed every time. / V made sure that THC pressing was never hard enough to break the apple seeds. / V thought the best cider apples were Gravensteins and the best eating apples Baldwins or Seek No Furthers. The sweet cider was Nectar, with the lovely aroma. The hard cider was pure and strong, and the Applejack had a kick that nothing else could equal. Applejack is simply the part of hard cider that doesn't freeze when hard cider is frozen. The part that freezes is thrown away. At the clam bakes we always sang. When we were only family or had old-fashioned guests, we sang the standard old tunes, and Mother's dear voice rang out with every word of every verse of John Assange, The Flying Trapeze, In the Gloaming, The Spanish Cavalier, Tell El / E, Kind Sir, Seeing Nellie Home, Now the Day's Over, Home on the Range, When Day's Done, and all the rest. 4 degrees. It was always beautiful at our clam bake place, but when the moonlight was on the water it was very lovely to sit looking at the ocean, singing with friends and being at peace with the world. Chapter 4. Childhood Memories. Once when I was a very small child, so small that I sat in a high chair to cat, Mother had a dinner party in honor of a French couple who were visiting in Wickford. The day of the dinner party I vaguely remember having to sit much too long in my high chair in the kitchen. Gladys, my new baby sister, was in her cradle asleep, as good as gold. Sarah Freeman, God bless her, took care of both of us and did the cooking. She and Mother did everything. Father got home on the 6 o'clock train from Providence to find knots going on the dining table set with all Mother's best glass and china, flowers all around, and me sobbing in my high chair in the kitchen. As if it were yesterday, I can remember my relief at Father's taking me up in his strong arms. I had stuck to the chair, I had been there so long. He took me out to the cool piazza and rocked me in his arms and sang John Assange, our favorite, and I went to sleep. Strange to say, this rather grisly ballad always had a soothing effect. As I remember, it went somewhat like this: A man whose name was John Assange, hath married Betty Haig, and though she brought him golden lands, she profited terrible plague, for all she was a scolding wife, full of caprice and whim. He said, that he was tired of life, and she was tired of him. Says he, then I will drown myself, the river runs below. Says she, pray do, you silly elf, I wished it long ago. Says he, you pan the brink I'll stand. Do you run down the hill, and push me in with all your might? Says she, my love, I will. For fear that I should courage lack, and try to save my life, pray tie my hands behind my back. I will, replied his wife. She tied them fast as you may think, and when securely done, now stand, she says, upon the brink, and 1 foot prepare to run. All down the hill his loving bride, now rail with all her force, to push him, and he stepped aside, and she fell in, of course. Now splashing, dashing, like a fish, oh, save me, Johnny Sands. I can't, my dear, though much I wish, for you have tied my hands. Mother is said to have been the first hostess in Wickford to serve something to eat and drink in the parlor before going into dinner. That evening she had stuffed eggs quartered, small hot rolls with bacon, and a French apéritif. Dinner was little neck clams on the half shell, a to a plate, with half a lemon in the center. Then clam broth, with whipped cream, in soup plates, with hot crackers. Then broiled Spanish mackerel with lots of butter and sliced cucumbers, then a crown rack of lamb chops, with paper trousers on the chops and the center of the crown filled with a delicious meat hash of liver and lamb. Currant jelly, mint sauce, ball fried potatoes, string beans cut a la Francoise, and hot rolls. Then a green salad. 42-45. With French dressing that only Mother could make, hot N, ACKCRS, and different cheeses. The dessert was Indian pudding and heavy cream. Coffee and liqueurs were to be served in the parlor after dinner to the ladies, while the gentlemen stayed at the table and had port. Unfortunately, just as Sarah served the rack of lamb and was passing the vegetables, there was a loud crash in the kitchen. Father rushed to see what had happened, and found that the stove had disappeared into the cellar. He looked O, W, N, and ETH ray on the back of the stove was the Indian pudding and GM its big iron kettle, quite undisturbed. Our kitchen had no cellar under it, so the stove only fell about our feet, onto gravel. Father and some of the other men could reach. Sinkers, milk in an open pitcher, cake, bread and butter. When the Freeman children went to raid the table, so did we, unless the governess bad cess to them happened to be after us. You're always welcome, darlings, Sarah would say. VHE and I was quite grown up. Her youngest child, Mamie, had such terrible adenoids that she could not breathe through her nose at all and never closed her mouth. I reported her case to a doctor friend, who said he would be glad to perform an operation. Sarah agreed to this, but absolutely refused to let Mamie leave Cedar Spring to go to the hospital, with or without her, so the doctor had to come to Cedar Spring. He also had to bring with him an anesthetist and a nurse. Everything went well until the anesthetic began to work. Dow to end. Put the fire out in the stove and pull up the Indian. When Mamie began to choke to death, the doctor almost pudding. IHCRE was no coffee for that dinner. Sarah Freeman, Ben's wife, was the only person in the world we were afraid of. She had been my nurse and had met Ben while taking care of me, so I was a special favorite. As I remember, she was the only person who singled me out for preference. No wonder I loved her. She was a tall, blonde Irish woman with the most beautiful eyes I ever saw. They were very light and perfectly blue, but she had to do such heavy long lashes that her eyes appeared to be dark violet except in a direct look in a very clear light. I have seen people start with surprise at the sight of them. She passed on these eyes to each of her five children. /VHE and we all playing together, as we did constantly, strangers observing us would say, "What lovely children." They always meant the Freemans. Sarah was a devoted and very positive mother. LV loved E, among other reasons, because she thought that when a child wanted to eat, that was the time it should. So simple, they ate all day. The table was always set with Johnny cakes. 44. Had to pull her tongue out to save her life. We learned that Sarah had given Mamie a donut and a big piece of cake just before the doctor had arrived, in spite of my stern warnings that Mamie should eat nothing. "Sure and no child of mine shall go hungry," Sarah said. The two exhausted doctors and the wilted nurse marched out of the house. Mamie bore the scars of her lacerated tongue to her dying day. Sarah's husband and her son Jonathan died, almost at the same time, from typhoid fever. They were stricken together, but Jonathan was the first to go. He had never in his life since Sarah had weaned him eaten anything but bread and butter covered with brown sugar. When he got typhoid, he would touch none of the medicines or broths prepared for him. Sarah grieved and sneaked food into him when she could, bread and butter covered with brown sugar, which perforated his bowels and hastened his death. Ben, like his son Jonathan, also died from an aggravation to his illness. He had always been terrified of thunder, and 45. At the first clap would hide. Just after Jonathan's death, when Ben's fever was at its worst, we had a bad storm. Dr. Metcalf, who knew Ben's terror, came and stayed with him. They darkened the room and did everything possible, but the storm came too near, and when a sudden vicious deafening clap ripped the air just outside the house, Ben screamed and fell over dead. After Sarah, our faithful hired help, married Ben Freeman, Nellie Forsythe took her place and stayed with us for years. She was a tiny, smiling Englishwoman who came to this country to be married, but when she got here she found her friend, Norton, married to another woman. The other woman was my great aunt M, a former spinster aged about 60, with a very bad temper. What had happened was this: Dr. Charles Henry Wheelwright, my great uncle and Aunt M's brother, had gone to the Siemens Institute in Boston, looking for an able man to live and work on Aunt M's small farm in New Hampshire. Norton at that time had been living at the Institute, very down on his luck, so he had applied for the job. He liked it, and until Aunt M wanted to marry him was very content. But marry him she did. He was a splendid-looking man, quite high class, and as she said to Mother and Grandpa Candler, was an answer to her prayers. Then Nellie arrived. Norton was very glad to see her, and said he was sorry, But he had no money and no place to go. And M saw no reason why Nelly should not settle down and do all the inside housework, but somehow it did not work out. So Norton wrote Mother to come and get Nelly. When Mother arrived in Peterborough by train, Norton met her in a high open buggy with Aunt M's one horse. He whipped the horse so much, going around the circle at the 46 railroad station, that the horse's feet went out from under him. The buggy tipped over and Norton was spilled out. A bystander said to Mother, "Don't worry. He always drives like that." Norton got out, set the buggy upright, sat on the horse's head till it found its feet, then climbed into the buggy, drove up to the station platform, and lifting his hat with a great flourish, said, "Oh, are you, Nita? Good of you to come." Mother did not spend the night. She and Nellie, who took to each other at once, took the afternoon train to Boston and thence to Wickford. Nellie was very happy with us and stayed 11 years. Then an Englishman named Grewcock started driving a back airy wagon from East Greenwich to Wickford one day a week, selling bread, cake, pie, etc., from the tail of the cart. He fell for Nellie, but Nellie was cheery, having been burned once, and kept him waiting 3 years. We all felt sorry for Grewcock and told Nellie this was her chance to have a home of her own. Finally she gave in. Mother said the weather had something to do with it. We had a beautiful warm spring, and evening after evening Grewcock would come in his bakery wagon and take Nellie for a nice ride. One horse died, and Nellie gave Grewcock $50 to buy another as a wedding present. All he gave her was a homely locket that had belonged to his first wife. But he did buy her the wattest wedding ring I ever saw. It went to the first knuckle of her third finger. The wedding was in our library on a Monday at 11:30 a.m. Dr. Goodwin married them, and everything went well on, till he told the bride and groom to kneel on a cushion Mother had provided. Poor Grewcock, as he kneeled down, let out an awful scream and yelled, "My God, I've got a cramp!" and hopped on one leg all over the room. I, aged 10, was the 47 bride's only attendant, and I dropped my small bouquet of daisies and rushed to him and pulled his leg and made him step on his foot, and the cramp let up. But he was lame until he left for home. Dr. Goodwin hurried the service, and we all went into lunch. Mother had ordered a huge wedding cake from Grewcock, at his suggestion, and had paid for it and planned to have it for lunch, but he would let no one touch it, and they drove off with the cake filling the back seat of the hired surrey. / V were all disappointed. We had counted on eating that cake. Chapter V. The Hay Barn. When I was 10 years old, my friend Emily Watenen asked me to come the day after Christmas and make her a visit. I had never been away from my family before, and although the trip from Cedar Spring Farm, Wickford, to the /Viterman's Farm in Potawatomi was only miles, it seemed to me I was going to the ends of the earth. I took two enormous bags with everything I owned or could appropriate from the rest of my family. I can still see kind M.R.S. Waterman's expression as our coachman staggered in with my valises. I was to stay 4 days. She asked if I needed both bags in the bedroom I was to share with Emily. Fortunately, I had packed all my clothes in one, which went upstairs. The other stayed near the front door unopened until I went home. The Viterman's house and family were delightful. Emily had 4 older brothers, Rufi, Willie, John, and George, and an older sister which seemed very exciting to me, the oldest in my family. They lived in a lovely old house in the midst of a great big farm with an enormous hay barn and cattle and horses and pigs and chicken and lots of dogs. Harris Buckland, with whom I had been reminiscing this story, tells me that he used to visit George, and that George's great big dirty mongrel dog slept in the bed between him and George. The dog was in bed when they went to bed. The /Vitermans lived in much more style than we did and had a man in a white coat to wait on table. I was much impressed. My mother usually had someone to do heavy work. 49. And wash dishes, but the less said about our help's manners and style the better. The first 3 days of the vacation passed in great contentment. To my surprise, I was not homesick at all. We walked and skated and visited the farm and made apple pie beds for the youngest two brothers, George and John. Willie and Rufi, the oldest, we were in awe of and so let them alone. M.R. Waterman was a great joker and teased us unmercifully, which I loved. He told me a story about a damn sight to tell my father. After 7 years I am still trying to think it out. I have always been slow at seeing the point of any joke. The day before I was to go home, we woke to find a big snow and sleet storm. Mrs. Waterman would not let us go out. George suggested hide and seek. We played it all over the house with such shrieks and yells that finally poor MRS. Vederman said we had better put our things on and go play in the barn. It was an entrancing place for children, a great big barn full of sweet-smelling hay. We slid down the hay from the loft to a pile of hay on the floor. I am sure the farmer hated us the next day, for at every slide we would pull down a lot of hay with us. Finally Emily said, "Let's climb up on the very top," it seemed like a mountain, "and slide down." She did it first, safely. She was much quicker and more agile than I climbed up and must have gone over the peak, for I found myself falling and sliding down the other side of the mountain of hay and next to the dam wall. I clutched frantically at the hay and tried to stop, but down I went into the dark and dusty valley till I reached the barn floor many feet below. It seems that there was a 2-foot space, for ventilation, left all around the loft between the wall and the floor, where the hay was piled. I, of course, did not know of it, and our much smaller barn at Cedar Spring had no such space. 5 degrees. 2. / Emily sensed what had happened, and yelled to George, who was in the harness room. He came and tried to push a ladder down, but couldn't. I had pulled down so much hay with me and tried to stop my fall that I had blocked the opening. George rushed to the house and got Rufi and the butler, and apparently everyone else on the place came, too, and they had the most awful time getting me out. I was nearly asphyxiated when George and Rufi bravely slid down beside me. They could not carry me through the narrow opening, I was too fat. Rufi stood on George's shoulders and they pushed me to the opening, and by the simple method of pinching my fanny very hard made me work to escape. They pushed and pushed and pinched and pinched. I was choking and crying, and they were choking too, and really risked their lives to get me out. As I struggled to escape them, I heard George gasp, "God, if we only had a headpin that would move her." I made one desperate lurch. The butler and Willie held the ladder firm, and I was out. I coughed and choked for hours, and my face was crimson and swollen and my eyes bloodshot. George and Rufi lay on the barn floor, and, brother-like, turned on Emily. "Don't you dare ever have another visitor, we will skin you alive," they said. When our governess bathed me the night I got home, she called Mother. "What can have happened to this child's back?" I said I had fallen skating. George and Rufi had done a good job. I was black and blue for weeks and sat down very gingerly. Animals have played such a part in my own life and in the lives of my family that they deserve a special place in this chronicle. When my brother and I were quite young, we had 3 goats, a billy goat, Pluto, and 2 nannies, Sylvia and Sin. 52. Ria. Later they had some very engaging kids. We loved the nannies and the kids, but hated Pluto, who grew ornerier every year. Mother made fancy single and double harnesses to our them of blue and white striped bed ticking, and we would hitch them up to one or the other of 2 goat carts. The harnesses were the breastplate type, collars were injurious to the goat's sensitive necks with hames and reins of leather. How he worked over those goats, we drove Pluto single, A to D, Sylvia and Cynthia double, and did quite a little work with the Pete, now the gardener, used them for carting grass CUTTMGS or apples from the orchard, or vegetables for the house from the garden. Sometimes we tried a spike team with Pluto harnessed in front, but he was always rude and would turn around and look at the nannies and be generally cussed. Even Pete's magic hand couldn't make Pluto behave. VHE and the cutes were young, they would scamper alongside the cart, one on each side of its mother. It was a pretty sight. I have a snapshot of me driving the cart with my macaw on my shoulder and the kids running alongside. I also had a cage lamb who followed me everywhere and would come into the house in the morning, run up to my room, and lick my face to wake me up. Lemmy Larney grew enormously big, the biggest ewe I ever saw, and had twin lambs every year for 14 years. We made a harness for her, thinking to hitch her up with Pluto. Hutchie W2S too smart for us and would just sit down. /VTNED many times, but she just sat. She was so fat and her vool so thick and long that trying to move her was like push MG a big soft boulder, with the same result. She loved to be hugged and would snuggle her smooth face into my neck while I hugged her as hard as I could. It was such a comforting thing to do. I was very particular how she looked and spent hours wash. 55. Ing and combing her wool. Once a year she was shorn. Pete did it, but I helped. She never moved, although if I nicked her she would jump but then lie still when I apologized and promised to be more careful. Pete, of course, would never cut any animal. I always took her wool to the mill to sell, and got a very good price, for it was so clean and of such good quality. She died at 17 years of age while we were in Europe one winter. Pete said it was pneumonia. We finally got rid of the goats, being unable to stand Pluto's bad behavior any longer. We sold them to some kind people who still have their descendants. Then we had two beautiful Shetland ponies, Dinah and Trixie. They were thoroughbreds and looked like miniature race horses with long manes and tails. They were very frisky and for a long time Pete had to help us harness them, for they kicked and reared and bit. But once harnessed and with us in the cart they would give us a fine drive, never walking, you couldn't make them just running or trotting all the way. When they came in they would always be so overheated that they had to be walked for hours to cool off. We used to bribe Pete to do this, for it got monotonous after the first hour. My macaw, Paolo, red and blue and yellow, with a long tail, was brought from South America by my mother's uncle Charles on one of his trips home from the Orient. I could do anything with him, and when we were together he would chuckle and make pleasant little sounds. When I rode my bicycle, he would ride on my shoulder. Sometimes he would talk a steady stream and sing songs for hours. Then again he would be silent for days. He could imitate anyone's voice and would call, Ninnit like either mother or father, and when I answered he would guffaw with laughter. When he wanted a bath he would say, 54. Bathe Polly. Bathe pretty Polly, until I did. I bathed him in about 2 inches of tepid water, and he loved it. He could fly anywhere, but liked mostly to fly over the house. He would take off on one side, fly over the roof and land on the other side, then do it all over again. He lived more than 100 years in our family and died from not eating when I went away to boarding school. I like to think that he was probably ready to die anyway. Pete knew how terrible I would feel at Paolo's death, and he persuaded Mother to have him stuffed. The taxidermist mounted him in a ring, and made him look so lifelike and natural that neither Mother nor Pete dared to show him to me or tell me what had been done. Mother felt she had made a mistake and did not know what to do, so she told Pete to hang him up in the lamp closet until she could decide, and then she forgot he was there. The lamp closet was a small, dark room where we kept kerosene, extra lamps, oil, glue, and so on. It was at the foot of the back stairs and a window on the stairs lit it up when the door was open. A few days after I came home on my vacation from boarding school, I needed some oil for my bicycle and went to the closet. There hung my precious pet, a shaft of sunshine lighting his beautiful feathers. For the first time in my life I fainted dead away. When I came to, Paolo was gone. Pete had buried him, ring and all. The taxidermist was very angry when he heard what had happened. He had wanted to borrow Paolo as part of his exhibition at the Kingston Fair, and said Paolo had been a stuffing masterpiece. Pete Freeman was an integral part of our lives. His knowledge and care of animals was extraordinary. We turned to him with all our animal problems and he never failed us. 55. Ye have just got to sit and think as to what they would like, he would say of a sick animal. And he certainly seemed to be able to understand what they wanted, whether horses, dogs, pigs, fowls, birds, or the monkey. The only living creature not his friend was my macaw, Paolo, but then, Paolo bit everyone except me. Pete lived at Cedar Spring in a little house down back of the horse barn and had an L fixed up as an animal shelter and hospital. He usually had something in it, a gull with a broken wing, a rabbit that had lost its foot in a trap, a pig sick with the thirp. I never knew what the thirp was, but many of our animals had it and Pete cured it. If they were low-key and wouldn't eat, they had the thirp. After Father died, Mother decided she would run a poultry farm. At one time she had 10,000 chickens, ducks, guinea hens, a noisy pest if ever there was one, geese, swans, and bantam chickens. I am sure there were other things, but thank goodness I have forgotten. / B raised only the best, and everyone, and I mean everyone, casual callers, relatives, neighbors, children, tramps, and gypsies, camping happily by the pond, unsuspecting of what lay before them, had to help feed, walk, chase, and care for whatever needed care. I can hear her now, hello, would you help me? And they always did. In all the poultry houses, we hung heads of cabbage by string so the birds would get some exercise by jumping off the floor. Someone had to put fresh cabbage regularly in every hen house, and all the children had to bring back horseshoe crabs from the beach for the hens. In the trout pond we had mallard ducks, and every day someone had to drive the ducks down the trail to the pond. They had to be driven home at night, as turtles, skunks, or woodchucks would have eaten them if left overnight. The gypsy children were the best duck drivers and did look cute. 56. With a branch of brush to guide the ducks and keep them in line. Saturday afternoon, after a terrible day of exertion, there would be a line of 20 to 30 people, old and young, waiting to be paid. Gladys and I, coming home at dusk from tennis in Newport, would see this group of discouraged humanity sitting in back of the barn waiting for Mother or Fred Sherman, our poultry man, to pay them off. But Mother and Fred and Mr. Stanley, the head of the gypsies, would like as not be off in the woods back of the trout pond, looking for hidden nests of some rare Cochin China hens. The Stanleys that year were on their way south for the winter, but they did not get away till frost. Mr. Stanley and Mother became so busy he could not leave. Mother did not pay him anything, any more than you would pay Queen Victoria for courtesies, but I remember that whenever I went by their beautiful painted van there was a smell of roast chicken, and all the children looked fat and sleek. Also, the van was opposite the cow barn where the milk cattle were. Mr. Stanley was an early riser, and morning after morning he and Mother sat on the back porch and had coffee at daybreak and planned the day. We won every prize that year at the fair. Mr. Stanley knew just which roosters to introduce to which hens to get the best chickens. He was really a wonder. One summer after Gladys had married Felix and gone to live in Germany, she came home to visit, and as she was leaving, Mother asked her if she wanted anything. Yes, said Gladys, Felix said if I could bring back a pen of bronze turkeys he would be delighted. Mother was to go back with Gladys for the winter and they were to sail from New York. I went in New York with them to see them off and we stayed at the Ambassador, the only hotel that Mother felt treated her Pomeranian dog, Folly, properly. Folly was tiny and her little. 57. Head was exactly the size and color of the heads on Mother's Russian sable cape. She went everywhere with Mother, and many people in church or opera or theater would start when poor tired little Folly would yawn and put out her tiny red tongue. We got to New York safely, the pen of turkeys on the rack on the back of the locomobile. The porters took our bags out at the hotel, but said we must drive to the basement entrance to leave the turkeys for the night. The turkeys didn't like it there and made an awful racket. I think every porter and bellboy in the hotel came down to the basement, and finally the manager, a Channing Frenchman, came and bowed over Mother's hand and said he was delighted she felt enough at home at the Ambassador to bring the turkeys. Mother explained they were sailing the next day and thanked him. He sent her a magnum of French champagne to the ship and a polite note begging her to come back soon and bring any of her friends. Offenda was Amis. 58J. Chapter 6. Teachers. Mr. Benny Bicknell lived in Lenton, Rhode Island, in a nice little white house with flowers and flowering shrubs around it. The red berries of honeysuckle and the red and yellow berries of the fireweeds lasted till the yellow witch hazel came out at the end of January. In the days when he used to come to our house to give us lessons, he always brought a bunch of something gay and lovely to put on the table desk in the bay window of our front parlor. He went to Providence on the 5:10 a.m. every day except Sunday. He would spend the morning studying at Brown University, and then took the 11 a.m. New York Express to Wickford Junction. Then he came to Cedar Spring Farm for luncheon classes. Our classes were from 1 till 4. It was a poor arrangement, for we had been outdoors all the morning playing hard, then we came in and had a big lunch. How Mother and Sarah Freeman could cook a great big baked potatoes with a huge piece of sweet butter stuck inside. Roast lemon gravy, roast beef and Yorkshire pudding, scalloped tomatoes with brown sugar, and chopped spinach with thick cream. Rice or bread pudding with lots of raisins, or floating island with currant jelly on each island, my, it was good. Old Mother always gave Mr. Bicknell a huge cup or two of coffee beside. After a lunch like that, and a long morning's play in the fresh air, we were overcome with sleep. Mr. Bicknell was smart, and in order to keep himself as well as us awake, he would read to us such lovely things as Alice in Wonderland. 59. Uncle Remus, King Arthur and the Round Table, Greek Mythology, Tom Jones, Kipling, La Rochefoucauld, and Little Woman. He had a beautiful voice and he loved to read. One very cold day, Mother came in to see why we were so quiet and found us all sound asleep with heads on each table. Even Benny was overcome and snoring. She decided then that we would have to have governesses. It was awful, for they were always around. No let up, as Father used to say. Also, we had got to know Mr. Bicknell so well that we used to ask him the most outrageous questions, and loved to see him blush. One very cold day, one of our pigs had a big litter. David saw her and called Gladys and me. As soon as a little pig was born, she ate it. It wasn't nice, but fascinating. / V cried and hung over the high board fence, and I called Pete, who came with Rick and pulled two away from her, but they both died. Pete kept telling us to go away, but it wasn't till Mother sent Mr. B to look for us that we left. How did she get the little pigs in her anyway? We asked poor Mr. B. And why did she eat them? And so on. His face was crimson, and as he had just heard that his thesis was very well received and that he had an offer from Columbia, he left. / V were all sorry, but his pleasure was very apparent. The first of a long series of governesses was a beautiful Madonna-like Russian woman of about 25. She spoke very little English, no German, the only foreign language we knew much of, and perfect French. Swedish, for some reason, was her native tongue and the language she scolded and swore in. She had a terrible temper and once tried to spank me with a brush. She was also very handy with a stick, and we learned to duck. Mother and father were in Providence at a party, and she said I needed training. I guess I did, but my lack of it stood me in good stead, and I took her and threw 60. Her face down on the bed and spanked her till she begged for mercy. David and Gladys jumped for joy and told me not to stop. She packed right up and was gone before mother and father got home that night. After that, we had a number of French governesses. They all liked father, and he hated them. Some were ladies and most weren't. Then came a series of German governesses. What queer habits they had all. They scraped their tongues with pieces of whalebone twice a day, wore queer underclothes and two or three pairs of stockings at one time. Finally, Fräulein Marie Emmerich came and was our dear devoted friend for many years. She played the piano very beautifully, and our evenings from then on were a dream. We could only sit up and hear her if we had done our lessons. How we worked, I really think all I know I learned from Fräulein Emmerich. She was a natural teacher and loved being one, and mother told us when we said our prayers to thank God that he had sent us Fräulein Emmerich. I did, for years, and not long ago one night when I was very tired and kneeling sleepily beside my bed, I found myself saying my childhood prayers: God bless mother, father, Gladys, David, and Fräulein Emmerich, and make me learn a lot. 5-1. Chapter 7. Three Murders. Cedar Spring Farm is known as the only place in Wickford where there have been three murders. One of these might be said to have concerned us directly, since it involved one who was very dear to us. The first murder took place when my father was a little boy, just before the Civil War. Our big hay barn with its great wide doors was formerly used as a clam bake house, and after a good bake and plenty of cider, the men used to pitch horseshoes and bid on their prowess. Sometimes, after the women folk left, or if it was a stag affair, they would fight game cocks. Cider seemed to make very ugly drunks, and many fights would ensue. One beautiful Sunday in September, after a gay bake, a man named Perkins was accused of cheating by pushing his horseshoe near the stake. "Let's lynch him," all they cried. He ran away from them, and that was the last anyone saw of him for more than a month. Then one day he was found shot to death, high up in the crotch of a great oak tree. He must have climbed the tree after his assailant shot him, for his wounds were such that he could not have been shot at that distance from the ground. Who did it, no one ever knew, but the enormous white oak, still standing, has been called Dead Man's Oak ever since. Dead Man's Oak is a quarter of a mile down the lane from Cedar Spring itself, and the house and barn near which the murder must have taken place are on a hill just above it. 6A. The second murder took place after the First World War, in the early days of Prohibition. Both Cedar Springs and our summer place on Narragansett Bay, Whale Rock Point, were involved. During that period we were kept on the jump by bootleggers and hijackers. Whale Rock Point, which juts out into the ocean, was a natural, the bootleggers said. They would run their high-powered speedboats, progenitors of the PT boats of the Second World War, out to the big vessels, carry the liquor 3 miles offshore, then make a dash for narrow river where trucks were waiting, unload in faster than fast time, and off they go. Of course, they didn't come every night, but on foggy or rainy nights we knew enough to stay indoors and see or hear nothing. The bootleggers were nearly and high-class men who felt they were in a legitimate business and would not shoot unless forced to. But the hijackers were daredevils with nothing to lose. Their only investments were guns and high-powered automobiles. One time my mother was ill and I was staying with her at Cedar Spring Farm. About 8 o'clock one morning, Ed Standevin, who had worked for mother for 42 years, first as farmhand, then as chauffeur, came into her room while we were breakfasting, and said, With a white face, one of those hijackers is sitting dead against the big sycamore tree up the road, shot through the head. / Mother asked, "Are you sure he's dead?" "Yes," answered Ed, "he's stiff." Mother never said another word. She reached for the telephone and told Mamie Rice, the telephone girl, to get John Fowler, one of the biggest bootleggers in town. Then after a minute, "Hello, John, is that you? This is Mrs. Baker. Come this minute and take your corpse off my place. How dare you do such a thing to Mel?" 65. In less than half an hour the corpse was gone. How Mother knew who had put him there, I never discovered. The third murder makes me so unhappy that even after all these years, I hate to write about it. Pete Freeman, who worked on our place and was so gentle in caring for the animals, always played the drum in the Memorial Day parade. Memorial Day was and still is the biggest day of the year in Wickford. The parade starts early and marches 2 miles to the Elm Grove Cemetery, where the graves are decorated and there are speeches and a band concert. Then it marches back. Anyone can march, but only a chosen few play in a band. As I see it now, Pete was lonely, especially during that winter and spring, when Mother was in Europe visiting my sister Gladys, and the house was closed. And because he was lonely, he began to drink. Ed Standiven was an awful tease when he had time on his hands, and to scare Pete from drinking he told him that if that didn't stop he couldn't play the drum in the Memorial Day parade. This preyed on Pete's mind. When Mother got home late in May, just the day before the parade, she found Pete half seas over. She got the cook to give him plenty of black coffee and told Ed not to tease him anymore. But the next morning, when Pete went with his drum to march in the parade, he was told that he was drunk, that he would have to go home. It broke his heart. He had played in the parade every year for 40 years. Slouching back he came, got his gun, and then came up to the big house. Mother was alone, for everyone else had gone to the parade. He mumbled something to her about shooting Ed. He blamed Ed for not helping him and taking his side at the parade. Almost everyone liquored up for the 65 occasion, and Pete was probably no worse than many, but Ed, to prove his point and stop Pete's drinking, had told the marshal that Pete was unfit to play his drum in the band. Pete was crazy mad, and when Mother low-kicked at him he realized that he was and that he would shoot either Ed or himself. It never entered her mind that he might shoot her. She begged him to give her the gun, but he wouldn't and said that he was going to wait at the gate and shoot Ed as he came in. Mother didn't know what to do. There was no way to warn Ed or get the gun from Pete, so she called up the state police and told them the story. They sent a splendid young trooper on a motorcycle right away. When Pete saw him coming, he ran down to his house and sat in his door with his gun across his knees. Mother warned the trooper, telling him to stay with her till Ed got back. Then Ed and the trooper could get the gun away from Pete. The trooper smiled and said he could manage Pete, and although Mother held onto his arm and begged him to wait, he went ahead. Pete put a small stick across the narrow path about 25 feet from his door, and as the trooper approached he said, "If you step across that stick I'll shoot you." The trooper smiled and said, "What have you got against me?" and kept on walking. Pete shot him between the eyes. He dropped dead instantly. Pete looked up to see Mother rushing down the driveway, screaming at him not to shoot the trooper, and then he realized what he had done. He ran across the barnyard to the old Stonite's house and barricaded himself in it. His poor dog followed him in. Just then Ed and the two maids came back from the parade. Mother was beside herself with grief and terror. They got other state troopers and had to shoot Pete and his poor dog to death before they could get at the trooper's body in front of Pete's shed. Pete had them covered from the ice house and there was no other way to get him out. 66. Chapter 8. The Fire Chief. George Cranston was a large, handsome man, one of the most influential in Wickford. He was chief of the fire department, the undertaker, and owner of the general store, about a mile up 10 Rod Road, where he sold everything: hats, toys, bicycles, coffins, buttons, kerosene, clothes, etc. He was big-hearted, able, and brave, and had a wonderful sense of humor. George was always gay and cheerful, and the only thing he hated to do was buy things for his store. That required thought, consideration, and money. He dearly loved to sell, but buying was painful. One day a week he would go to Providence to replenish his stock. He went on the early train, the one we children took to go to school spring and fall, and the one my father always took as long as we lived in Wickford. / Winters, when the weather was bad, we had governesses and studied at home. We children and our father always got on the train at the new railroad station. It was on the little branch railroad that ran from the dock where the SSNOS, which plied to Newport, used to be moored, through our farm and other farms, to Wickford Junction, where it met the main line from New York to Boston. George lived not far from the junction, and on his shopping days would wait to leave his home to catch the train till he heard the whistle at the Swamptown crossing. Then he would leg it up the road. He was always in a hurry, his hat firmly on his head, dressed in his red flannel under drawers, with his coat and shirt unbuttoned, and his trousers streaming out behind, held to him by his suspenders. 68. Around his neck. He would button himself up en route. And the men aboard the train, my father among them, would help him along by screaming down the road, "Hurry P. Georgia, we're going go." Then someone would BLW the whistle. Sometimes the conductor would start the tram and pretend to go. George would add speed, and always made it. He would put on his trousers on the back PLTFORM. LH1 shat on more firmly. Then come into the car with the arrow at Chester VLD, bowing and shaking hands with all the ladles, and PASSMG the time of day in a most courtly manner. It was George who always told me the news of the town when I had been away. I had just returned from UFW and he told me about the railroad station fire. I remember thinking, as he told me, how tame Europe was, just one big hotel after another compared to /V1CKFORD, where some thing was always going on. The old railroad station in Wickford burned to the ground in the middle of the night. It was a fine gingerbread type of building and most sturdily built. The fire came at a most inopportune time, as the annual squirt was to be the next day. A squirt is a water pumping contest to see how far water from a given fire engine can be thrown. The pumpers are volunteers who have to train as a team for the squirt. The engines are worked singly, and the contest is to see which team can shoot the water farthest on a marked roadway. Each team has two tries, along each side of the engine, about 2.5 feet from the ground, is a bar which is the pump handle. 12 men, 6 on each side, work the bar up and down, and that pumps the water. Since Wickford has had a modern chemical engine, the old one has been used only in contests. The old one is very beautiful, made of iron and brass, the iron painted bright red, the brass polished till it glistens. 7 degrees. Many other towns have had pumping engines with their teams of picked men. It is a great honor to be on a team, and requires lots of practice and great strength and endurance, for it is a back-breaking job. Up and down, the pump must go in perfect timing. Hiccups once lost a squirt. Eddie Fowler got them and threw the team off beat. My father was on the Wickford team for a while, but a case he had in court made him miss a squirt, and he was dropped from the team. The other men said he lacked civic pride in letting anything interfere with a contest. As luck would have it, Taunton, I think, won the squirt my father missed, and held the championship for quite a while. A team had 5 minutes to warm up. Then the judge yelled, "Ready, on your mark, set, go." The squirt lasted 10 minutes, and the greatest distance was usually reached after 6 or 7 minutes of pumping. Sweat poured off the men, who wore only trousers. George Cranston, the captain of our team, wore a hat, too, or at least he did after the railroad station fire. George had been captain of the squirt team for years and gave the beat for the pumping. First slow, then faster and faster. Up and down, 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 4. He sang a kind of chant that was mesmeric, and most of the bystanders would be swaying up and down, with the pumpers, so that when a contest was over, both the team and the audience were tired out. The night of the railroad station fire, 3 flat cars were lined up at the station, with their fire engines on them. Some of the engines and teams had come on flat cars, and the men guarded the fire engines day and night and spent much time sitting and gossiping together. The cars had easy ladders up to them, and food and equipment were stored on the cars. 71. Under huge canvas covers. All the children in town climbed on the flats and made pests of themselves, asking questions and getting underfoot. Engines from nearby towns were drawn to Wickford by horses. One engine had 3 horses abreast. 7 beautifully polished engines were quite a sight. Everything was peaceful and quiet, and the town was asleep when one of the guards on a flat car woke to see the station ablaze. One would think that with 7 fire engines and all those men, the fire would have been put out quickly. Horses were run to the saltwater cove nearby, and the pumping of water to the fire began in earnest. But there was too much equipment. The men and engines got in each other's way. The hose got tangled, the men swore at each other, the townsfolk rushed home for their leather fire buckets, our three always hung under the stairs, and soon there was a hand brigade passing buckets of water to the fire, but nothing helped. It was the hottest and prettiest fire I ever saw, all colors, from the paint and tar and chemicals that had been stored in the freight shed. The station burned to the ground, and two flat cars and engines burned also. George Cranston, who was fire chief and had rushed to the fire faster than anyone else, was very brave. Sparks were flying, and it was terribly hot. We children, with my mother and her governess, were huddled across the tracks under a big oak tree on the rails land, looking fascinatedly at the fire. A big brass cuspidor that had been in the men's side of the station was on the ground. George yelled to Nat Perry, who was holding a hose nozzle, to turn the water into the cuspidor. It went in with a rush and made quite a nice fountain for a minute and washed out the cuspidor. George grabbed it and put it on his head. It was a good protection from the sparks. 72. All went well for a while. Then Mother pointed to George. Oh, look, the poor man, that thing has gone down on his nickel, it had indeed. Probably the sweat from George's head had made it slippery, and the heat from the fire had expanded the cuspidor. There was George, helpless, completely blind, and suffocating. They had a terrible time getting that cuspidor off George. Someone made a hole in the top to give him more air, but the cuspidor still stuck. It would not pull off. They nearly broke George's neck pulling. They tried to file it off, but it was well made and of heavy brass. Finally Nick Ramsbottom, the plumber, got his torch and burned it off. George was very weak and lying on the ground by then. It was an eerie scene, the crowd anxious, tired men around George, well lighted by the embers of the now burned down station. Nick Ramsbottom's torch burned poor George's head pitifully, and my father told us later that George had a round ring of bright red scar around his skull. That was why he never took his head off. It was some years before we had another squirt. The new station in Vicford was not a very nice building. It was a great disappointment to Henry Congdon, the genial and faithful conductor on the branch train, and to all of us. It was a quarter of a mile up the track from where the old station had been and not a convenient place for anyone. Since the new station was built, passengers from Newport would look in surprise when the train stopped at Wickford, for they could see only a shed. The shed was the station, a nice cozy place, though, and presided over by a kindly but proud despot Clarence Weaver, station agent, baggage master, janitor, and everything else. 73. George said that the fire at that railroad station started at night too, and as usual, no one knew the cause. George had just retired as fire chief, and at the meeting a few days before, Sam Brown had been elected to succeed him. All the firemen came to the fire with a beautiful new chemical engine which the town had just bought. Just as they got to the fire, Sam Brown, George's successor, cried out, "Wait, boys, I forgot my chief's helmet." He rushed home, and when he returned with it the station was in ruins. The boys had waited. George Cranston's store was a big barn-like building at the crossroads which used to be called Cranston's Corner but now for some reason is called Consolation. This store was turned down after George died. Now a four-lane cement road runs past the site and the stoplight blinks where George's friendly windows used to glow. Winter evenings were especially cozy, and around Christmas I doubt if George closed the store at all. He would stay open as long as anyone came to buy. There was no clock watching, although a handsome grandfather's clock stood against the wall to the right of the front door. George's office was a walled-off space in the corner of the big front room, and the clock was on that wall. Catter-cornered, and to the left of the front door, was a long wooden bench seemingly made for little children. I have sat there many, many hours while my mother shopped and talked to George and other friends, and there were always other children there too, sucking candy or peppermint sticks and sleepily watching the ship on the top of the clock's face rocking gently to and fro. In the middle of the room was a high pot behind stove with a stovepipe held by wires to the ceiling. Tall men such as my father and George himself had to duck under the stovepipe. 75. Around the room were endless tables, all piled high with articles of literally every kind and description. Beautiful English leather saddles and bridles and harnesses and whips of all sorts hung on one wall, colored lithographs of Niagara Falls, the capital in Washington, Sir Walter Scott and his dogs, mourning pieces, a large tombstone, a weeping willow, a woman at a child's grave, all hung on another wall. The third wall had shelf after shelf of preserves, jellies, vegetables, pickles, and so forth. I don't seem to remember any canes. Strips of bacon and hams hung on hooks, and a long white marble meat-cutting table ran from the other wall of George's office to near the back door. On the other side of the hack door was a trapdoor, and a ladder, only used in very bad weather, led into the cellar. The usual entrance was a fine, wide outside stone cellar steps with double doors always kept open. George's son, who was half George's size and was therefore called Demi John, lived in the cellar, endlessly emptying things from large barrels into smaller barrels, pails, casks, and bottles. He never seemed to come out of the cellar and smelled ML stinkingly of cider, kerosene, vinegar, salt army, grape WME, pimps, turpentine, sweat, and shaving soap. His hands were dead white from the acids, and he had a thin ring of soap suds and his urzaru in his face, up to his ears and duvet in his neck. His wife made him shave every Saturday but omitted to see if he washed properly afterward. Sometimes the ring was whiter than others, but usually there was at least a trace. We always looked carefully to see. Demi John was considered quite a weather prophet. He used to look out at the square piece of sky frame by his cellar door's end. As at the weather. He was apt to guess right and gained quite a reputation for doing so. He was outclassed only by Weaver Rose. Weaver Rose predicted the blizzard of 84. That put him in a class by himself. Demi John did pre. 76. Died the fire at the sand hole, or at least that morning he said he felt in his bones that something awful was going to happen. It wasn't much of a fire. Most of the firemen were at the sand hole, anyway, when it started from a lighted pipe in Dewey Hopper's back pocket. Dewey had been helping Dirty John with some paint, and his overalls were ripe to catch fire. It really sobered Dewey for quite a while. He never knew anything about the fire until it was out. He was happily unconscious while he was rolled out and his clothes pulled off and the sofa he had been asleep on was thrown out, and the burning curtains pulled out and thrown outdoors too. S.L. Horsford, with burned hands, and Dewey himself, with a blister on his back, were the only casualties. Dewey helped George as a sort of runner. He was also supposed to be polite to any visiting clergy when they came for their handouts. Dewey thought it was funny to load all the food into the same bag, a big scoop of beans, rice, tea, ricins, or dried fruit. The parson never said a word except, thank you, but how mad his wife or housekeeper must have been at having to sort out all those grains. All the clergy gave George their undertaking work. Dewey tried to help George on that end of the business, too. When George found out eventually how mean Dewey had been about the food, he decided to pay him back. They happened to have three stiffs in the undertaking parlor at the time, and one empty coffin waiting. After they finished work, George said to Dewey, I'm going down to the barber shop. You shut up shop here but come in again before you go home and see if you think Mr. Hunter here needs more ice. Dewey hated to go into that room alone but he was afraid to disobey George. While Dewey was shutting up, George moved one of the bodies and put the empty coffin where it had been and 77. Climbed into the coffin himself. After about an hour he heard Dewey coming. Dewey opened the door to D. Peart via RFULLYN, holding his kerosene lamp up above his head. At this moment George raised himself up in Peter Lawton's coffin and said, you white-livered cockroach, you would cheat the clergy, would you? I'll haunt you to the end of your days. Dewey let out a terrible howl and ran 2 miles to the sand hole, still holding the lamp. He never quite recovered from this experience. Chapter 9. Mr. Northrop's Remains. Our Wickford dressmaker told me the story about one of her relatives. Mr. Northrop was a nice big-boned man, happily married to Amanda and the father of 8 children. The children had come as fast as nature allowed and the oldest was just 11 when Amanda got measles. There was an epidemic at school and the 5 oldest children who went to school had light cases and were soon well. But Amanda was different and in an incredibly short time to everyone's horror she was dead. Mr. Northrop had realized 3 years before how busy Amanda was and had gone to Ellis Island and brought home a big blonde 16-year-old girl to help her. Ermentrude had worked hard and loved Amanda and the children, but now she was 19 and saw her chance. She told Mr. Northrop she would not stay unless he married her. Poor man, what could he do? He asked the minister, but he had no ideas. He asked Mr. Northrop if he didn't like Ermentrude. Mr. Northrop said, why, I like her all right. I don't think I ever really looked at her. Well, said the minister, have a look, I think you are in luck. The day after Amanda's funeral, Ermentrude went to Providence and bought a white satin wedding dress, white shoes, white gloves, and a lace veil, and she produced from somewhere a brother, also big and blonde. The brother Herman moved right in and fixed up a place. 79. For himself in the woodshed. He said for the bridal couple to go on a honeymoon and that he would look after the family. He did, and the children adored him. He played the harmonica and sang and danced. Mr. and Mrs. Northrop had a nice honeymoon on Blocker's Land. Life went on very smoothly for 3 years. Ermentrude had 3 children, and with Herman's help and that of Amanda's 2 oldest girls, life was rosy. Herman and Mr. Northrop were both skilled masons, and soon found more business than they could attend to. While life was so happy and prosperous, a bad windstorm blew down Mr. Northrop's chimney. After the blow was over, the 2 men climbed on the roof to estimate the damage. "That band some blow," said Herman. "We'll have to get some lumber and make a scaffold, then we can see to build her up," said Mr. Northrop. They were in a hurry because there was lots of other work to be done, and they built a flimsy scaffold. Herman said he would climb up and build the chimney, but Mr. Northrop got stuffy. Herman was getting too bossy, and he told Herman to go mend the Cartwright cellar steps and let him alone. The following day, when Joe, Amanda's oldest boy, got home from school, he went around the house and found his father lying on the ground, dead, with a piece of scaffolding piercing his body. Herman took charge. Ermentrude had a miscarriage, twins. It almost broke her heart that she had to go to the hospital and miss the funeral. She was chief mourner and told Herman to buy a lot in the new part of the cemetery and tell George Cranston the undertaker to plan a double gravestone for her and Mr. Northrop. 80. Amanda was buried in the Northrop's lot with other relatives, and Mr. Northrop had put up a double stone there for her and himself. Is Forsythe, the cemetery superintendent, told George Cranston that Ermentrude had bought a lot and had ordered a grave dug for Mr. Northrop. George told Herman, who went to the hospital and told Ermentrude. Ermentrude got right up and came home and went to bed there. She could control things better at home, she said. The funeral was postponed. Ermentrude was adamant. "He banned my husband and he's going to be buried in my lot," she said. Amanda's children, the older ones, went to their aunts and uncles and their grandmother Northrop and said they wanted their father buried beside their mother. HRMSTE bent forward and said to George Cranston, "Let us divide him and put half with Amanda and the other half in Ermentrude's lot." But how was he to be divided, straight up and down or across? Feeling ran high in town. After much talk, Herman and George Cranston got together and decided to have Mr. Northrop cremated and the ashes divided and half put in each lot. "It was the biggest funeral anyone ever saw," Miss Roberts said. Ermentrude, in heavy widow's weeds, lay on a chaise longue in the front parlor beside a closed coffin. George Cranston was not GOMG to be cheated out of selling a coffin. 8 Ilven children were there. Herman held the baby, a DARHNGHTTLE blonde S, LFL of 13 months. The next baby, a boy of 2, sat beside his mother and sucked his thumb contentedly. Miss Roberts finished the story with, "They all seem fine and the children are doing well. But my cousin from Utica telephoned the other day and said, how does anyone know that Herman is Ermentrude's brother?" Chapter X. The Lighthouse Keeper's Daughter. Years ago, Jesse and Sarah Sherman lived in the lighthouse 2 miles offshore, with their father and mother. The father, Peter, kept the lighthouse and was an essence addict. He drank vanilla and lemon extract and used to be drunk for weeks at a time. The family and everyone else in town were afraid the federal authorities would find out and Peter would lose his job. Jesse and Sarah were expert lighthouse keepers from the time they were 8 and 10 years old, and took splendid care of the lighthouse lambs. MRS. Sherman was so fat she just sat. /VHE and Sarah was about 18. She had a beau, Ned Perry, a high-spirited fisherman with his own boat. Ned wanted to marry Sarah and take her ashore to live. She wanted to marry Ned, but insisted that he live in the lighthouse, for she would not leave Jesse to run the light alone. Her father was a dodd-daring fool who only knew enough to sign the semi-monthly government checks, which were their only support. Ned would bring Sarah ashore for shopping and supplies, and they would fight and argue all over town and ask everybody's advice as to what to do. The town was as divided as they were. Ned certainly didn't want to support all the Shermans, which he would have to do if they gave up the lighthouse and Jessie couldn't take care of it alone or said she couldn't. Finally, another girl, May Taylor, began to make up to Ned, and told him he was a fool to wait any longer for Sarah, for she would never marry him. One lovely June night, Nat 83 went in his boat to the lighthouse and told Sarah that if she did not come with him that very night and be married, she would never see him again. Sarah, of course, did not believe him, but he meant it, and married me that night. It would have been hard enough on Sarah anyway, but what he did afterward nearly killed her. The next day he repented and went to the lighthouse and told Sarah that he was married but that he hated May and the fault was all Sarah's. May, all this time, sat bobbing about in Nat's boat, tied by a rope to the lighthouse. She had brought the license with her, in case Sarah did not believe Nat was married. After Nat left in the boat with May, Sarah fainted and was unconscious for 3 days. Peter had to sober up and get a doctor, and Mrs. Sherman had to help Jesse tend the light, a kerosene light in those days. Just as all this was happening, of course the government inspector had to come. He saw what a bad way things were in. Peter lost his job and all the Shermans were moved to the mainland and a new keeper installed while Sarah was still unconscious. They found a place to live, and Sarah stayed in bed for 40 years. Mrs. Sherman and Jesse took care of her. Peter died soon, but the government gave Sarah, Jesse, and their mother a small pension. While Sarah was in bed, she did beautiful sewing and used to make all her underclothes and nightgowns. It was always so queer to have her try to fit the things on us while she was in bed. One Christmas Eve, after she had been in bed for 40 years and MRS. Sherman had been dead for some time, their house caught fire from a candle in the window blowing against a lace curtain. Jesse had gone to church, and Sarah was alone. She screamed, but no one heard her. She tried to walk, but couldn't, so she crawled to the front door and down the street in the ice and snow to the next house. The neighbors came, got the fire apparatus, and put out the fire. But Sarah in her nightgown caught pneumonia and was on the verge of death for several weeks. Everybody in town spent their savings to pay the doctor for pulling her through. It seemed so futile. Sarah died 9 months later. 86. Chapter I. Two other sisters. Abby and Lucy were sisters and spinsters and the last of a distinguished family. They had one brother, who was a great trial to them. He bent his elbow, as we say in Wickford, frequently. And he died quite young. As soon as he was gone, he became their beloved little brother, and my father had difficulty in remembering the respect he had to show Joe's memory. He had spent many a Saturday night raving from one dive to another to get Joe for the girls. Abby and Lucy would come tearfully and beg him to go and get Joe, and he would start off in the buggy and drive till he found him. Joe was a small man and never put up any fight when my father, who was very big and strong, picked him up like a baby and drove him home. The girls were always grateful and would give my father lovely presents, to thank him, but nothing made it up to my mother. The only times she really lost her temper were when my father went on those rescuing trips. She was afraid my father would be hurt, and she and Abby and Lucy did not become friends till after G-Zero died. Then they became very intimate and Abby and Lucy were always at her house. They sewed beautifully and always carried gold thimbles in the pockets of their dresses. They dressed just alike, but each wore a different color. Abby had red hair and blue eyes, so she wore blue or black. Lucy had dark brown hair and eyes, so she wore green or brown. The boys in town named them black and tan. They wore lots of petticoats with a ruffled white Swiss M. 87. Broidered one on top over the lot. They wore their skirts to the ground in tight-fitting bodices. Each held up her skirt in exactly the same manner as her sister and showed a small triangular bit of immaculate white starched petticoat. They wore small high-buttoned black shoes and were dainty and feminine and adorable. How we children loved the days they spent with Ussel. They sewed and mended and talked with my mother of this and that, but always gently and kindly. They were very religious, and I think it was their influence that made my mother become an Episcopalian, although she had been brought up a Unitarian. Abby was godmother to my brother, David, and Lucy to my sister, Gladys. David and Gladys, because they belonged to Abby and Lucy, went very often to the Great White Sherman farmhouse for the day. They told me stories of eating all the cookies they wanted, of playing hide and seek in the attic, and finally being walked home in the dusk by Winnie, the little maid who had been there 50 years. In spite of / Vinnie's loyalty and honesty, Abby and Lucy were very suspicious. For instance, sometimes before they went out they would put a letter on a table with one corner under the table mat. Or they would take a pencil and mark the position of a card on the card tray in the entry. If these things had been so much as breathed on, they could tell. VH what made any difference we never knew, but they would nod their heads in unison and say to Mother, "Yes, she picked up Peggy Hidden's letter. We had the place marked, so we know." Mother would soothe them and tell of some of the really awful things her help did. We always spoke of and worried about what would happen if one sister died. They were so united and always said, / V. 88. Think, we did, we have a cold, we're never separated, and lived for each other. One lovely spring day, Winnie telephoned and said that the ladies, who were now in their 80s, had a cold and the doctor thought Miss Abby was far from well and could I come. When I got there, each sister was sick in her adjoining room and Lucy was miserable enough not to know how very ill dear Abby was. Abby died that night. Lucy was quite calm, said she would be with her soon, said a little prayer, and asked me to telephone the undertaker. She did not want the local undertaker, as there had been some unpleasantness at Joe's funeral. The sisters had not thought Joe looked his best. When the undertaker from Providence came, Lucy sat up in bed and told him why she would not have the local undertaker and that Abby was to have every attention. The funeral was delayed 3 days to give Lucy time to get better. Finally, all was ready. Lucy, dressed, but very white and weak, came downstairs. The coffin was to be opened so she could see Abby and it was to stay open during the health ceremony. The undertaker took off the top of the casket. Lucy gave one look and gave a little scream. Why, that is not Abby, who is that woman? Although Abby was over 80, her red hair had never become white. The poor undertaker had curled it in a most fashionable manner and had given Abby some long, curling, black eyelashes and quite a lot of rouge and very pink lips. He had put a tight collar on so her neck did not show, and, really, she could have been any age and she looked lovely. / V did have a time. The eyelashes would not come off, although the undertaker tried. It was very unfortunate. Some of the rouge was washed off and Lucy had to be content with. 89. That, for the minister had just come and the mourners were coming in the door. The coffin was closed. Dear Abby, all she had spoken of and bemoaned her very light eyelashes many times. Perhaps she was glad to have the dark ones. RGO. Chapter XII. Mike. One autumn, it was 1903, as I remember, we were delayed in London until nearly Christmas. I had gone to Europe with my mother and two sisters, Gladys and Ruth, to put the two girls in a French boarding school. But our maid, Marie, became very ill in London, and it wasn't until one day in December that we left Charing Cross Station for Dover and the Channel boat. It was raining hard, but we had a comfortable second-class carriage to ourselves and we settled Marie with pillows behind her back. Mother, my sisters, and I sat anywhere, surrounded by our luggage. There seemed to be a good deal of commotion at the station as we left, but we didn't pay any attention. When we reached Dover, the rain was still streaming down, and a howling gale was blowing. Why we did not think of waiting until the storm was over, I do not know. We hustled aboard the boat and Mother said to me, "We will sit here and wait. Go and try to get a stateroom to put Marie in. I think it is going to be very rough." We had two porters carrying our bags. One porter put us down beside Mother, received his pay, and left. I turned and saw the other porter going into a stateroom with the rest of our bags, among them the one that held our tickets and valuables. I darted after him frantically. As I got to the closed door of the stateroom and started to go in, I was grabbed by the arms by two of the biggest liveried footmen I had ever seen. I struggled to get free, saying, "The porter is stealing our bags and tickets. I must get them. I let me go." Nothing happened. Just then the door of the stateroom opened and our porter came out. Sitting opposite the door at a table were three men, two in uniform flanking a third in civilian clothes. I screamed to our porter, "You have stolen our luggage," and appealed to the men not to let him get away. Dead silence. After a little, the man in the middle said something to the footman holding me. They pushed me into the room and closed the door behind me, never relaxing the grip on my arms. For once I knew what fear was. I was desperate at our plight. I had failed Mother and had lost our tickets, our valuables, and our letters of credit. I didn't know what to do or how to get away. Sensing that the young civilian was the person in authority, I turned on him. "How dare you bring me here and steal our things?" I shouted. He looked terribly surprised and said, in perfect English, "Mademoiselle is an American?" "Yes, I am. But that is no reason for you to be a thief. Please, mademoiselle. Then he said something else to my captors, and they let my arms go. Finally able to move, I was turning to go out when I suddenly saw, in a corner, Mother's cape and the precious bags. "Those are my bags and my mother's cape," I cried, pointing to them. "Oh, Mademoiselle, I am sorry," he said, standing up for the first time. He asked questions. All the men shook their heads. "Do not think too badly of us. It was a mistake. I do not know how your things got here." "Of course you know how they got here," I stormed at him. "You thought you saw an easy way to steal some nice things. You are a miserable thief. Now, let me go." 92. "Please don't go. Do sit down and tell me where you came from. Are you going to Paris? Sit down with a robber?" I sneered. "No, then will you not shake hands, as this is all a mistake?" "Shake hands? Of course not. I wouldn't touch you with a 10-foot pole. I want my things and I want to get out of here." I pointed out our belongings to the footman, who carried them out. I took the ticket bag in my hand and went outside. That a storm had blown up, the mother had found a stateroom, and the footman put our things in it. She was furious with me for going off and leaving her, and she had been worried about the luggage. I was too dazed to explain. F/V sister Gladys said we were lucky to get a stateroom. "The Grand Duke Michael, the Tsar's brother, is on board," she explained, "and has taken nearly all the staterooms. He has just been on a state visit to England and is going back to Russia. He is young and terribly good-looking, the stewardess says." So that was who the robber was, so I felt faint. I had to have air, and in spite of the storm I went out on deck and hung over the rail on the lee side. How rough it was, so I would probably have been seasick if I had not been so excited. I had been standing there about 15 minutes when I sensed someone beside me. I looked up, and there was the Grand Duke. He looked scared to death and his voice trembled as he said in a rush, "Don't be cross, there is so little time. Do tell me your name. You know I did not mean to cause you trouble." I stammered, "I am so sorry. I did not know who you were, Your Highness. Never mind being so formal." He laughed. "I have never, before or since, seen such beautiful teeth. You have already." 93. "Called me thief, and robber, and untouchable. Perhaps you could call me Mike. My mother does. There is the coast of France. We will be in soon. Hurry, tell me, where are you staying in Paris? How long?" / "That's your name and your banker, in case I do not soon get back from St. Petersburg." "Where do you live in the United States? Whom are you traveling with?" I answered his questions, and all the time the boat was bobbing around like a cork and we never noticed. "I must go," he said then, and repeated my whole name. "Don't forget me. And perhaps it is not I who have stolen something. It is, I think, Miss Anita Woolwright Baker." He was gone. A long time afterward he told me that he and his party thought I had come to the cabin to shoot him, and were terrified. They did not show it. We were kept waiting at the dock at Calais for hours for the Imperial Russian party to land and be put aboard their special train to Russia. When we arrived at the hotel in Paris, our rooms were a bower of the most beautiful white violets and white roses, my favorite flower. Mother would not go in. She said there was a mistake. The flowers were not for us. And anyway, she would not pay for them. The maitre d'hotel was very solemn and said that he had no idea where the flowers had come from, but he did treat us with great respect. From then on I was conscious that I was always being followed, always being taken care of. We would come out of the theater and find no cabs. In a minute one would pull up near us and the driver would say, "Voila, Mademoiselle," and in we would get. On Christmas Eve we went to midnight mass at the Madeleine, but there were no seats. Someone tapped me on the shoulder and said, "S'il vous plaît," and motioned. 94. Us to follow him. We were given good seats up front. I do not know how it was done. We got so used to these courtesies, and to the never-ending flowers, that we hardly noticed. I never said a word, but hugged my secret to myself. I never had a letter or card and had no address to which I could send my thanks. Then one day while Mother and I were in Sicily, we read in the newspapers that the little Tsarevich had been bombed and that there was great rejoicing in all Russia. That meant the Grand Duke Michael was no longer so important in the line of succession. My sisters were in boarding school, and Mother had had a bad cold. So we had decided to take a trip to Sicily before the Easter vacation, when we would have to be back in France with the girls. Mother and I were staying in Taormina at the old monastery made into a hotel. It is a most charming place, with a gorgeous view over the Mediterranean. I was taking a rather boring walk in the garden one hot midday after lunch, while Mother was resting in our room, when I heard my name called. There he was. I hardly knew him. He had seemed so sedate on the Channel boat. Now he was young and gay. He held out both hands and shook mine up and down. "How are you?" he asked. "Did you get the flowers? Wasn't it the most colossal luck that that baby was a boy? I feared that they would never have one, and that I would have that yoke around my neck always. Isn't this a nice place? I never was here before." I didn't even tell my mother then who he was. She had forgotten the Channel episode and had never actually seen him. She thought I had picked him up in Taormina, but he was attractive enough to make her forgive me and think me lucky to have such a delightful, entertaining friend. 95. What fun we had! We climbed Mola, a small mountain just back of the hotel, from where we had a lovely view of Mount Etna and the superb colored patchwork of the surrounding country. Mike was an expert mountaineer and a great friend of the Duke of Abruzzi, one of the greatest of mountain climbers. / V played tennis. He played badly, for he had never had much chance to practice. I played badly, too, though I had had all the time in the world to practice. / V played in the garden of the beautiful old Greek theater until the German Kaiserin and her oldest sons came to Taormina and put everyone off. They were quite stuffy, and we were very humble. I can see the twinkle in Mike's eyes now as we stood beside the road and bowed low as the German royalty rode by. All too soon we had to leave. At Palermo we took the train for Syracuse, where we saw the strange ear of Dysius. It is a huge cave, in which the slightest sound can be heard for a quarter of a mile. "We had fun whispering to each other rather," Mike whispered. He called me a thief, a robber, and an untouchable. Back in Palermo again, we stayed only a day, just time enough to visit Monreale, that gem of a cathedral, and the Concordiero, shell of gold, where the steeplechase was being held. It is the most beautiful sight I have seen for a race. Most of the jockeys were officers in dashing uniforms riding their own horses. I win and Mike lost on the races. "Unlucky in gambling and lucky in love," my old nurse used to say, he remarked, which seemed to please him. We had a grand dinner at a special restaurant whose name I have forgotten, and went aboard the steamer about 10 p.m. She was someone's private yacht, small and unseaworthy, and on the way to Naples we had a terrific storm. The boat stood first on one end and then on the other. I was terribly 96. Sick. Mother, in her bunk, just hung on and never said a word. / V were too exhausted to go farther than Naples, and spent 2 days there. / V went to the opera and just happened to hear Caruso that night in Aida. Is it possible that anyone else ever had such happiness? Afterward we walked back to the hotel through gardens along the waterfront in the moonlight. It is lucky that the walk was not too long, for when a beggar asked us for money Mike gave such a lot that the news traveled fast, and soon we must have had a retinue of at least 50, all praising us and singing with happiness. Mike emptied my bag and his pockets, and then turned them inside out and said, "Now we are beggars." They laughed and blessed us, and Mike told them we needed their blessings and their prayers. / V went into the hotel with their vivas ringing in our ears. He had to leave the next morning, and I did not see him for many months, but now I did get an occasional letter brought by messenger, which I answered the same way. It does cramp one's style to know that a messenger is sitting in the next room, waiting for an answer. And I know that my letters were stupid and stilted. My father and brother David joined us in the spring, after David's term at Andover had ended. We met them at Cuxhaven and then came back to Hamburg and had a wonderful reunion. The next morning father asked me to walk to the bank with him. "You have changed, dear," he said. "Are you happy? You seem thoughtful to me. Your mother tells me you have a friend. Tell me about him." It was fun telling him everything. He laughed at the Channel boat story and said right away, "Why did you let the bag with the tickets out of your hands?" 97. At the bank father found a letter from Mike asking if he could come and call on him. Father wrote and said he could come as soon as convenient, and told him our plans. Mike couldn't have been very far away, for he was with us by lunchtime. It amused me, for Mike was as nervous as a debutante. I had never heard him stutter, but now he seemed hardly able to talk. Father was adorable to him. I don't know what they said to each other, for all I heard as they started out for a walk after lunch was, "Don't apologize to me, boy, I love her, 2. Father told me later that Mike was moving heaven and earth to renounce his right of succession, take one of his lesser titles, and marry me. His mother and the Tsar had consented and were delighted at the thought of his happiness. But until the Tsarevich was older and stronger, nothing could be done. Mike told Father he was glad I was so young, for I could wait, and he would wait forever if there was a chance. We sailed home in the fall, and though gifts of flowers, candy, and fruit and an occasional letter continued to arrive, I did not see Mike for a year. Early the next October, on a beautiful warm day, I was in the kitchen making apple jelly. I heard someone come into the back hall and open the kitchen door. I turned, and there was Mike. I nearly fainted, and he had to catch me. The week Mike was at Cedar Spring was a week in Emil. Ion. The weather was absolutely perfect, and the foliage at its most gorgeous. We used to ride up to McSpern Hill and look down at Narrow River, a blue ribbon amid the brilliant oranges and reds of the trees. In the distance we could see the little white South Ferry Church, and beyond it the open Atlantic. Mike couldn't get over the colors. He was much changed now. When I could catch a glimpse. 98. Of his face in Rayos, which was seldom, he looked very sad. The HTTLE Tsarevich was sick, and it had been discovered that, EW2SAHM? Filiac. There was no chance for Mike to relinquish his right of succession. I knew he had come to say goodbye. / V spent that week picking apples and carrying the buckets swinging between us to the root cellar for storage. We laughed and talked and he told me many stories of himself and he Russians. To this day they keep coming back to me. Mike loved to learn the foolish toasts we all said in those days, such as, a Frenchman loves his native wine, a German loves his beer, the Englishman loves his half and half, because it gives good cheer. The Irishman loves his whiskey straight, because it gives him dizziness, the American has no choice at all, he drinks the whole damn business. Bet, in the E2G, Ishman and the Irishman, Mike inserted a Russian, HKE this, A&D vodka as to all good Russians, a comfort each day of the year. He also liked another one, man is somewhat like a sausage, very smooth upon the skin. But you never can tell exactly, how much hog there is within. But there was one that he criticized, ah you're not my first love, one love before we met, and the memory of that ardent love, is lingering with me yet. I-99. You are my last love, the dearest, sweetest, best. My heart has shed its outer leaves, one give you all the rest. That is foolish, Mike said. One can really love but once. The night before he left, Mother had tactfully gone to bed early, and he and I sat in front of the smoking room fire. Little Nini, he said, marry the good Frank and soon. And have lots of babies to play with. It is best so. I have had my week of heaven. One should not ask for more. He stood up and took my head between his hands. I closed my eyes. I could not look at him. He recited the sweet poem of Heine that I have always loved, Du bist wie ein Blum, so hold uns gehen und rein. L.C.H. Schadich and, unwemmet, schleicht mir ins Herz hinein. Bierestels obich dahin aufs Haupt dir legen solt, betend, das Gott dich erhaut so rein und gehen und hold. You're like a lovely flower, so fair and sweet and kind. I gaze, and a sense of foreboding, troubles my heart and mind. I think I ought to be laying my hands on your head in prayer, asking that God may keep you, so good and sweet and fair. Then he said a few words in Russian that I did not understand, turned away, and looked into the fire. 100. He did not turn again, but said shakily, please go, darling, and don't see me off in the morning. I can't stand it. Paul is taking me to the station. If you need anything, ask him. And don't ever forget you have given me the only happiness I have ever known, and until I die I will love you. I stumbled out of the room and cried myself to sleep. I never saw him again. Years later I heard, indirectly, that he had died in Russia. After Mike left, his attendant, Paul, stayed on. He was the man I was never to notice, but who took care of me. I used to try to see Paul, but he would never talk and would run away if he saw me coming. He lived and worked at the Balkans place and was such a good hand that nearly all the farmers in town tried to hire him. About 2 years later I married Frank. I told Paul I was to be married. He bowed politely. I asked him to come to my wedding, and his face lit with pleasure. He came to the wedding. At the end of the receiving line, there he was. He wished us happiness and said he would drink our health as I had asked him to. Then he handed my husband a small box. "For your wife, with the good wishes of an old friend," he said. I asked Paul if he had news of his Highness. "Yes, good news," Paul said. "He is a farmer, too, in the west of Russia." There was no card with the gift. It was a beautiful circle of diamonds, with a diamond and platinum chain. With my wedding, Paul's vigil was over. 102. Chapter XIII. Whale Rock Point. After Frank and I were married, we bought Whale Rock Point, a farm belonging to some cousins, right on the Atlantic Ocean near Narragansett Pier, and we used to spend over 6 months a year there, from spring through autumn. I wanted to be near Mother. The place is just 10 miles from Cedar Spring, and Frank wanted to be near his mother and father, who went to Saundersdown in the summer, just halfway between Cedar Spring and Whale Rock Point. Our twins, Gladys and Francesca, and my brother's twins, David 4 and Ashton, were christened in the old Narragansett Church in Vicford. We had two ministers and a bishop for the event. My husband and I couldn't decide on names. Four daughters were too much for us. Nita, our eldest, had been named after Mother and me, and Elizabeth after my mother-in-law. VHAT to name the next two was beyond us. I knew that even if I had 20 children I would keep going till I had a son, so I did not want a Francesca. But Frank, my husband, was a little bit discouraged and wanted a child named for him. One of the twins looked very much like him, so we agreed on Francesca for her. I wanted Gladys, my darling sister's name, for the other one. Then Frank decided his favorite name was Edith. I had never heard that before. And my mother said she really felt that with four daughters, one should be named for her mother, Lucy. M.R.S. Hinckley, my mother-in-law, who had been very gentle and quiet up till then, said it would make her very happy if we named one of the twins Felicita. 103. Mr. Hinckley then spoke up for the first time and said he was glad he had no daughter. He was only joking, but Mrs. Hinckley looked as if she were going to cry, so I told her I would surely name one of the twins Felicita. We were off then, and everyone in the family, about 30 in all, including three godparents for each child, and they had ideas, too, took sides, fighting and arguing, but we couldn't come to a decision. We argued right up to the font. Finally my brother, David, said distinctly to the bishop, "You will start baptizing the Hinckley children, I will tell you the names." And he did. He gave each child all the names that had been suggested. It was a successful christening in more ways than one, for one of the boys' godfathers met and fell in love with one of the girls' godmothers, and before long we all went to the wedding. About 4 years later, when Frank, J.R., was christened, I tried to make him wear the beautiful christening dress that Nita and Tina and generations before them had worn. The twins had to be dressed alike, so neither of them could wear it. I suppose the dress was rotten, it was so old. Anyway, Frank was very hick for his age, and unusually strong, and he gave a kick and a leap as the bishop took him to carry him to the font. The dress and the old slip that went with it split and fell off him, and he was baptized in his daubers and shirt, with the dress and slip draped over him as best we could. I never saw anything disintegrate as that christening dress did. Buddy, as we called Frank, J.R., was about 5 when we were out walking in Narragansett one day and came upon a very dead horse in a field off the highway, where it had been struck by a truck and killed. Its side had been cut, and the intestines were coming out. Blood was on the road, making a path to where the horse lay. 104. Buddy was intrigued. I thought I would never get him to leave such a fascinating scene. Early the next morning he made me take him again to see the horse. It was even deader now. Flies had come, and we scared away 2 crows. The third day the wind had changed, so we knew we were coming to the horse long before we arrived. It was horribly unpleasant. "Buddy," I said, "take a good look now, for I simply can't come again to look at this horse." "Mother," he said plaintively, "isn't it too bad you and your little boy haven't the same tastes?" It was, and I was ashamed. We visited that horse almost daily until there were only bones left. The house in Narragansett burned down, for no known reason, one beautiful Sunday morning in July. We were 32 people in the house. The Roman Catholic help had gone to 9 o'clock Mass. Mother, who was visiting us, and I were having our breakfast cosily in her room, and Buddy had just come in to say good morning. I heard a queer crackling noise coming from the third story, and Buddy WCNT to see what it was. "I shall hear his terror-stricken voice till my dying day, Mother, the house is on fire." I rushed upstairs. The ceiling and sewing room were ablaze, I slammed shut the door to the sewing room, screamed, fearful, and opened the door across the hall where the only son of some dear friends was asleep. I yelled, "Sandy! Get up! The house is on fire!" With one leap he was in the middle of the room. As he jumped up, the blazing ceiling fell on his bed. He would have been killed if he had not been as quick and lithe as a cat. 105. We did everything we could to save the house, got the garden hose playing water on the roof in no time, used all of our many fire extinguishers, and called the fire department. Mother's chauffeur, Ed Standevin, and a youth visiting us, climbed onto the roof and nearly got caught when it fell in. It was all a nightmare. The house burned to the ground in 28 minutes. When the help, who had left the well-ordered house at 8:45, returned from church, they found only a smoking ruin and most of us in our nightclothes. / We were able to save only a little furniture and a few books. Petey, the monkey, was so frightened at the first smell of smoke that he found a hiding place, and when the firemen got there they thought we were all crazy, for instead of trying to save our furniture and other inanimate possessions, we were all crawling around on the floor in our nightclothes, looking under things and calling, "Petey! Petey!" Nita found him at last, under a corner cupboard so low to the floor that no one knows how he ever got under it. The firemen chopped away the wall, and Petey was taken out safely in Nita's arms. The dogs and cats and Tommy, the raccoon, saved themselves and came trembling up to us out on the lawn while the house was hurting. We sat there exhausted and bewildered on some rescue chairs and sofas, surrounded by everyone in the county. How people do love fires! They all came to ours, and many helped themselves to souvenirs. I heard one supposedly dear friend say to his 10-year-old son, "Here, Phil, take this book home. It might have burned up." Phil took it. I was too sunk to say anything. Another youth, trying to be helpful, said brightly to me, "Well, anyway, MRS. Hinckley, you had a lovely day for the fire." I suppose he meant it wasn't raining. 106. After the house at Whale Rock Point burned down, we went to live in the old Potter farmhouse, and strangely enough that burned down too when it was struck by lightning. That was a shame, for it was one of the quaint old colonial houses I have described. It had a big front door with no transom, and two smaller doors opened from the small square entry inside, one into the parlor, a big low-ceiling room with a fine fireplace and mantelpiece and four windows, the other into a similar one opposite. Back of these two rooms was the kitchen, with an enormous fireplace and a big crane for cooking, from which hung an iron pot supplying constant hot water. At each end of the kitchen was a small square room. The one on the right was called the bombing room, and woe betide any child who messed up that room. Boarding rooms were always placed next to the kitchen, so that new babies might be kept warm by the heat from the fire. My husband, who was a poor sleeper, appropriated the room over the boarding room as his. One rainy day, when Frank had sciatica and all the children were inside, my son and nephew Harold were playing in the attic. I heard my husband calling, "Come quick!" Frank, J.R., and Harold had got off the planks in the attic and were standing on the lath and plaster, which was all there was to the ceiling of Frank's room. I rushed in, and there were two pairs of little boys' legs hanging over Frank's bed, and Frank covered with plaster. We moved Frank next door into my room. And then my sister and I stood on Frank's bed and each held a child's legs, while Mary O'Brien, our factotum of many years, got a small ladder from a toy fire truck and gently pushed it. First to Frank, J.R., and pulled him up, and then to Harold. Both boys were cut by the nails and iron spikes and quite badly hurt, but they soon healed. Arnie was one of my children's friends. At his fifth birthday party, his mother invited our two older daughters, Nita and Tina, but said plainly she could not ask the three-year-old twins. I dressed the big girls, who were 5 and 6 then, and set off with them to the party. The twins came along in dirty play suits. It didn't matter how they looked, for I intended to bring them right back home with me. All the children arrived at the same time, and in the confusion of getting into the house the twins crawled under the arms of the bigger ones and disappeared. And I finally found them. They made such a racket that MRS. Porter said, "Never mind. Put these big bibs on them. There's plenty of ice cream and I really need you to help me, as Bridget is sick and Mrs. Harrington couldn't come." They're vasplenty to do, and it was a fine party. Well played all the children as games we knew blind man's buff, lawn don bridges falling down, pin the tail on the donkey, and after a while we played forfeits so that everyone would have to sit down and be quiet for at least a minute. The twins, full of ice cream, were sitting sleepily on a sofa at the back of the room, their fat legs stuck out straight. W2ERN's urn came to bow to the prettiest, kneel to the woundest, and kissed one he loved the best. To his mother's and my surprise, he went over to Gladys. "No, dear," said his mother, "she's not in the party. Choose one of the other little girls sitting in the ring." "No, I like her best," he said, and kissed her grimy little face, made a polite bow, and knelt down. Years later they were married, and from the bits of letters I am allowed to air today, I am convinced that he has never changed his mind. 108. Chapter XIV. More pets. My children had three memorable pets: Tommy, a raccoon, Red Mouse, a dachshund, and Petey, a Capuchin monkey. The raccoon was the nicest of the pets. We acquired him one day in a little town in Georgia, while stopping at a gasoline station on a motor trip. We happened to notice a little darky walking down the street. Every now and then he would stop, turn around, and call, "Come, Tommy, Cornel." A little ball of fluff seemed to be following him. We investigated and discovered an adorable little raccoon that seemed to know its name and followed its master when called. / we bought him and kept him with us all the time we remained in the South. He was absolutely clean and housebroken, and washed all his food. Cereal or mashed potato would rile the water. He wouldn't touch the food then, but would look up pitifully until clean water and a carrot or some other solid tidbit had been given him. This he would wash thoroughly, turning it over and over, inspecting it minutely and picking off invisible pieces of dirt and chaff. He and the dachshund, Red Mouse, slept together, all rolled up in a ball. Sometimes Petey, the monkey, slept with them, but he was too capricious and occasionally for no reason at all would pinch Retronus, waking him up. Then the raccoon would wake up and there would be a wild commotion. Petey was a Capuchin monkey, about 14 inches tall, with a long tail and a cute little black cap. He was given to Nita by a friend, John Richmond, who had bought him in Panama. After eating he would always run his so human log hands over the white collar and vest of his fur to see if he had spilled anything. He kept himself immaculate. It was Petey who nearly lost his life when our house at / VHALE Rock Point burned to the ground. Beside Rat Mouse we had many dogs of almost every known breed. My first dog was a tiny real pug dog, gray fawn color with a black nose and tongue. My father brought him home. A tiny puppy. In his overcoat pocket. He was very intelligent and we taught him to play hide and seek. / V would set him on a chair with his back toward us and tell him to stay till we called. Then we would hide. He would look for us and find us all in a remarkably quick time. It was much more fun to have him always it than to take turns ourselves. Later I had a French poodle, Paul Plankin, very stupid, who slept all day and barked all night. He didn't last long. Buck was an Airedale who lived to be 18 years old. Gladys had Cocker Spaniels. First black, then brown ones. Mother had a beautiful Pekingese, Ginger. Her last dog, who lived to be 19 years old, was the tiny Pomeranian, Folly. Mother gave Buddy a rough-haired Irish terrier when Buddy was 3. Buddy loved him immensely and named him Christmas Present from Grandma Baker. He was called Christmas for short. At the same time, the little girls had Dr. Day, a Boston Bull, and Dempsey, a mongrel shepherd who just drifted in. One fall a beautiful female Airedale came to us. We tried to find who owned her. She was evidently well-bred but couldn't. Ed Baton, our caretaker, said he would like to keep her, so she stayed at Narragansett. He named her Mabel. One bitter cold night she had 14 puppies. Poor Ed tried to keep her warm and take care of the puppies, but she died on the evening of the second day afterward. He waited, till morning. Then, since the ground was frozen, he took her body and put it on the compost heap and covered her over with leaves and manure. He had a terrible time feeding all those puppies. Using a few milk bottles and nipples, he would no sooner finish than he would have to begin again. He gave them one feeding in the middle of the night. On the third night, about 2 a.m., when he was finishing with the last puppy, he heard a scratching at the door. He opened it, and in walked Mabel. He thought she was a ghost and screamed. She weakly licked his hand and went and lay down with the puppies. He fed her warm milk, and in a day or two she was well. But Alice, she had no milk, and to see her sit and watch poor Ed feed her puppies was a caution. Pete came down from Cedar Spring to consult and help Ed, and took some of the puppies home. They all grew up moan growls. Mabel lived for years, but had no more puppies. / V had a pair of wild geese for years at Cedar Spring. One May Pete found a wild goose with a broken wing. He set it, and she seemed all right, but did not fly away. The fall, as the geese flew over going south, she called her mate. He came and stayed with her and never left. They raised many geeselings, all of whom would join the flock of geese going south each fall, and we would never see them again. The parent birds took it very philosophically and didn't seem to mind. Animals or zoos provide wonderful means for answering sex questions, and rabbits in the backyard are the best of all. Buddy, at 5, was almost in tears at Smokey's treatment of Snowball, his wife. "Mommy," he said, "we must take Snowball out of the cage. He is so mean to her. He never leaves her alone at all." "Perhaps she likes it," said his grandfather. "No, she doesn't, and I am going to be nicer to my wife than that." Ill. Snowball lived in solitary grandeur until the baby rabbits were born, and the tender care given to her and the little ones by the children was really touching. Some weeks later, while the children were at supper one night, I overheard Buddy say, "I think she'd like some more babies now. Let's put her back with Smokey." Nita asked, "VH, why do we have to put her back with Smokey?" "'Cause it takes a father and a mother to make babies. The father gives them to the mother, and she has them." "Oh. It takes a rabbit 6 weeks to have babies, and we only have 7 weeks till school, so we have to hurry. Won't she mind leaving her little babies, 1, 2, and 3? "No, they're all right now. They eat like anything. Nita, you put her in with Smokey. She likes you best. Anita is very gentle, and both Smokey and Snowball eat out of her hand." They all started for the rabbit hutch. Of all the children, Nita is the most religious. She believes what sweet Sister Paula tells her in the Episcopalian Sunday School and uses her religion in her daily life. One afternoon, during her first year of school, she came home to find her cousin Priscilla locked in the bathroom. / V were all in the hall outside the door trying to make Priscilla open it. We had done and said everything. Margaret had called in M.R. Flaherty, the officer on our beat, but so far he had been no help. At the moment Nita arrived he was saying, "We think we better call the Florida department. With the ladder they can climb in the window and get her out." "Dinita, I know what to do, sister, wait a minute. Sale, Paula told me I will pray." The darling little indigens folded her hands, and Sal, in the door of the bathroom. Diop, the door opened, and out walked naughty two-year-old. "Priscilla. 1 inch, there you seal," said Nita. "It is a RMRAC. We all agreed that it was. 112. Why, I am happy. Now that I have reached 80 years, I am alarmed at not having told my beloved fellow man one of the sources of my happiness. Almost every day someone says to me, 'You are the happiest person I ever saw,' or, 'Why are you so happy?' Years ago, a discerning and observing man, Henry D. Sleeper, at whose beautiful place in East Gloucester my HS band and I were visiting, said to me, 'I have been WATCHMG you ever since you came, and I think you are the only perfectly happy person I ever knew.' I made a reply, 'Why wouldn't I be happy? You are giving us such a lovely time and you know how I adore your exquisite taste and the beauty of this place. No, that's not it. It is something in you, but I felt sure you would not tell me. I wish I had, but as always, I was shy and timid and knew I would be laughed at, as I was whenever I did try to talk about it.' Dean Philemon F. Sturges, one of my husband's and my best friends, said when I tried to tell him of my experience, 'Now don't go psychic. You are not the type. Say your prayers night and morning, send your children to Sunday school, and be good to Frank. That's your duty in life.' Now Dean Sturges and Harry Sleeper are both gone, and many like them have thought me happy, but if before I go I can make one person a little more contented and give one soul a little lift and be less afraid to die, I will feel repaid. 114. And grateful to my Heavenly Father for making me so happy and giving me such a wonderful experience. After my first daughter was born, I had what are called postpartum hemorrhages. Later it was discovered I was a partial hemophiliac. My blood coagulated imperfectly in 18 minutes. Normal blood takes, I think, 5 to 8 minutes. I was young, and the baby was big and fat. The doctors and two nurses did everything possible to stop the hemorrhages, but after trying frantically for a long time, dear Drive. Mitchell said shakily to a nurse, Tell her husband she has gone, and he fell sobbing on his knees beside my bed, putting his poor head on my hand. He had worked over me for 2 days. At that moment I felt myself leave my quivering, pain-racked body. I was free and floating upward. I looked out and saw myself white as chalk with the sobbing doctor beside me. Then the walls and ceiling of my room disappeared and I was in a place of such beauty and radiance that it defies description. Everything was happy and serene. I was being welcomed and longed for by beings who loved me and wanted me to come. There was no hurry. I just hung in space in a divine enchantment of well-being and contentment. As I was floating far away, I looked down again at myself and the kneeling doctor and I saw the door open to let my husband in. I was very far away and they looked so small. Then my baby cried, and my father was there, up high in the sky. He had died 10 years before and had been ill and gaunt and haggard. Now he was young and handsome and so happy. He held his dear arms open to me with longing, but he shook his head and looked out at my family. I knew from him, although he did not speak, that my work here was not done and that I must go back. But I felt I could not go into my most unattractive form. I tried with all my willpower, again. 115. And again. I would go down, then I would float off again into the peace and glory of that heavenly vision. Every time I floated up it was more alluring and I wanted more to go to my father, but although his dear face was loving and tender it was stern and quite severe. I must go back. I was told afterward that for more than 20 minutes I was dead. There were no heart stimulants or injections in those days, and only my father's firm determination sent me back. I hovered over my body for some time. But I sensed approval for what I was doing, not only from my father but from others of the heavenly throng. I do not know when I entered my body, but it was with such a jolt and jar that I felt sure the doctor and the nurses and my husband would hear, but they did not. It was some time before they noticed. Then dear Miss Falvey cried, "Why, she is breathing ill." One thing I have not told was that while I was floating my body seemed to tingle in ecstasy. I have been a happily married woman for years and know the pleasures and delights of married life, but this was far greater, for performance and bliss seemed to enter, and I was conscious that immortality and peace were forever at hand. Is it any wonder that I am happy when I have this knowledge of what awaits us after death? My next experience is less inspiring. I was sitting under an apple tree on our farm in Wickford, peeling apples for a pie. And every now and then I would stop and pray a little. I love to pray out of doors. It seems so near to heaven and is the nearest I can get to the radiance I once saw. I was praying for many things. The end of World War I. This was in July of 1918, the recovery of my mother from an illness, safety for my dear sister married to a German, and also for my son. I looked up. And there for the fraction of a second was the radiance I fell on my knees. Thank you, dear. 116. God! I cried, it was gone. I suppose I was too eager, perhaps if I had sat quietly I don't know. It is a long time ago that most of these stories happened. As far as I can remember they are true. Sometimes I have changed names so as not to embarrass families. As Grandma Moses said to me at the first exhibition of her paintings in Stockbridge, Massachusetts, when I told her I wrote, "Write for your own pleasure. I paint for mine." Then at least one person is happy. Wickford Memories. Bye. Anita W. Idingley.